I'll be the hero.
When we were packing up last time, couldn't find.
What day is today?
Thursday.
All day.
Day four. On the 12th of January, we're gonna call this meeting.
Game four.
Of the Board of Selectmen. And the first thing I would like to do is open this to any public comment that is on anybody's mind. Naturally, budget related would be most appropriate, but whatever's on somebody's mind. Yes.
We're all way back on 1961, 1967 to 2017, considering this will be my 50th budget coming up. Just wanted to go by you. 1967, the population was 21,188, now 26,220. Number registered voters was 10,481, that's opposed to 18,980 today. That's in part because the voting age is changed from 21 to 18. I think the most astonishing one that I read here, in 67, the school population was 4804, it's now 4300, so it's roughly 500 students less. They had 332 employees, they now have 700 plus. So that's 700, that's 378 more employees. Police and fire department have 44 men and 8 callmen at that time. They now have 47 and 1 secretary. The dispatch of 11, public safety total was 91 then, it's just about 90 now.
You missed the police, Bill.
Do I miss the police?
You did.
They don't count.
Mark that down.
We have 43 police and now have 41, so we've actually gone down to, plus they have a couple secretaries, so. But just about even 50 years.
Kind of interesting information, Bill, 50 years.
I like to do that.
Where did you find this information?
My town reports that I have my library, which is in my bedroom. And a little inquiry to the police chief, the fire chief, and a few other people. It was funny because when I walked into the school, nobody knew exactly. There's about a dozen of them sitting around there, so come on.
Thanks for doing this, Bill.
Well, to your point the other night, John, on the nighttime government. Sadly, I think it's time that we fold in our former government and go to city.
Say that again?
I think it's time that we fold in the town meeting and go to city form government. When you have 112 out of 192 town meeting members show up, that's four. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
We've got men and women serving in this country and dying for this country. People don't get a room without coming out to vote. I'm sorry. It's time to, in my opinion, and I sadly can say that, as you know, I love to be here. It's time to look at another form of government.
Can you explain how
nobody's been to more of them?
Huh?
Nobody's been to more of them.
I know.
As you move into your 50th year.
You have a question?
No. Any other public comment?
John, the only footnote to this kind of puts a period exclamation point at the end of the sentence last night around police. We talked about a 15-year study. This is now a 50-year look back. And there were two more heads, full-time equivalent heads with the police, with 5,000 more residents. Don't know how many household that is, but.
Fewer.
It is interesting information when you think about the public safety report last night from both chiefs, actually. You have 25% more people. You have Chief Burns talked about some of the projects, the housing projects that have gone up.
That's the delta between.
And, you know, and the demands around public safety, you know, on all of those that have been built kind of on the perimeter of the town. It is interesting that 50 years later you have 25% more population and public safety has not grown. As a matter of fact, in some cases, it's shrunk. It's a real issue, and I think when we get to the 24th, that's a topic we're going to have to consider and talk about.
Thank you, Bill. It's very interesting.
Yep. Thank you. Any other public comment? Okay. Amy. Library time.
Just really quickly, I just wanted to give you an outline of what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about the budget directives that were given, as well as, like the other presentations you've heard, a little bit about the general department overview. We'll look at our 16, fiscal year 16, which is what we have for complete data, and also look at the trends of what's going on, and that's all before we actually get to the fiscal year 18 budget. We have three major directives when we go to design the budget. The first is our core library mission, which is to provide free, open, and equitable access to information and resources that are essential to sustaining the educational, economic, and civic well-being of our community. Just note that it doesn't say anything about books in there. That is a smaller piece. We also have a town manager recommendation every year. This year it was extra fun because somewhere in the middle of the summer it was been a lot more. We got an override, and then at one point it was going to be -7. And so we've worked with a lot of models, but the final objective was to get the overall budget increase no more than 1.25%, while also increasing our wages, our non-union town staff increase up a step, which is 2%, and a 0.75% COLA. So that is the challenge. And finally, we are also required to maintain minimum standards for free public library services. This is a mandate from Mass General Laws and CMR. It requires a minimum of municipal appropriation, minimum number of open hours, and a material budget allocation. So that's just a little background. We have a board of trustees. We actually don't have a quorum yet. But we have three of our trustees here, David Hutchinson, Alice Collins, and Vicki Yablonski. I report directly to them as the library director. Rounding out the administrative side of division of our library, we have a senior administrative assistant who supports the entire department, does all the billing and payroll, et cetera. We have an assistant director. That position is open. And then four actual divisions: circulation, technical services, children's, and information services. Circulation, technical services, children's, these are just library terms. It's very standard in any library structure. To give you an idea of what they do, the circulation and technical services are primarily sort of in some ways back of the house. They manage patron accounts, they manage software, and the actual running of the function meeting rooms, the museum pass software, all that CAD, event management, calendaring. They do the acquisitions. We acquire about 12,000 items a year. All those items have to be cataloged, they have to be processed. They also deacquisition or deaccession a certain number of items, and they also handle the interlibrary loans, which I'll talk about in a little bit. The Children's and Information Services divisions work more, they're more less about things and more about people. They actually target specific areas: early literacy, which is birth to age 5, school age, which is primary elementary school, teens, adults, and then elder services. So each of the librarians that are working on these have specialties in these areas. We do work with a strategic plan. I think other divisions, departments call them master plans. We're required to file one every 5 years with the Mass Board of Library Commissioners. Some of the things we've been working on in 2017 include a Hallmark Center, Maker Programs, an Entrepreneur Series, and we touched upon it last night. Jane Burns and Eugene touched upon the Memory Cafe. We are, one of our goals is to do more cooperative programming and resource programming with other departments within the town, so that's just an example. Going forward, we just had to file our next action plan based on our strategic plan. We will be doing more outreach to the preschools and RISE, in addition to just general work with the Redding Public Schools. We're hoping to be able to develop some content sharing and e-learning tools for those people who can't make it to the library. And one of the things that's out there that we'd really like to do, if we can, is to apply for a townwide preservation assessment grant. so it's, I know it's something that's very important to not just the library, but other departments in town. So during fiscal year 16, we were open for 3,063 hours. It roughly averages out to about 60 hours. We're open 60 to 63 hours a week, less holidays and snow days and things like that. We answered over 51,000 reference and research interactions. It's about 17 questions per hour while we're open. And one thing that we don't really report on, I feel like publicly, is that we do have a lot of volunteers. We average about 22 hours a week of volunteer service, which is almost a half an FTE. And we could not do some of the services that we do without volunteers. We do have obviously paid work, but we do ask and look for teen volunteers, adult and older adult volunteers for a variety of things. One of the things that we do is our homebound services and takeout. We currently have about 25 residents on the roster, and this means that on a bi-weekly basis, they have materials dropped off and picked up. This is a very hands-on, labor-intensive, but very valuable service. We do not have to be permanently homebound. If you have a knee replacement or a hip replacement and you just can't get out, you can apply and we'll come help you out. But it is something that we do, and that actually, it's been growing a little bit over the years. We also provide reading collections here at the Pleasant Street Center, Sanborn Place, and Sawtelle Hospice House. So I just wanted to present some of the ideas that it's not just in the building, because I know that probably a lot of people are curious about the building, but a lot of what we do is not necessarily just in the building. For those of you who often hear that libraries are going away and there's no reason for us to have a library, the circulation still remains a huge part of what we do. We had over 400,000 items checked out. That's 134 items an hour going out of our library that were open. And you know what? All those items have to come back in. So you can take that number and you can just imagine what a busy place we are. I also wanted to just mention something we report to the state every year. It doesn't necessarily come out here and running. We talk a lot about resource sharing, and we do have a couple areas that we do resource sharing. And one of the things is by remaining certified, we have the privilege as Reading residents to obtain materials from any library in the state, and we also get materials from outside the state. So this year, in fiscal year 16, we received almost 30,000 items from other libraries, and we also lent 27,000 to other libraries. This is a cooperative program, and it means that it allows the library to curate their collection so that it really is hitting what we feel is either the majority need, the most popular need of our community, or very specific targeted needs based on a very an identified group of users. So it allows people who are not in either of those categories to obtain materials. I also included a couple pie charts, because everybody else had a pie chart in their presentation. So, I said, what can I do? Our ILS is our integrated library system. It really does allow us to have an incredible amount. We have a tremendous amount of information about what we do. This is just sort of a real popular, people want to know how many books do we, how many print items do we circulate. It's about 72% of what goes in and out of the library. Videos, electronic, audios. People also want to know, well, how many, you know, what kind of age groups are you servicing? This is actually a reflection of the material, not the age of the person checking the item out. So the age of the person might be 40, but they're checking out a children's book. But it is a good snapshot to see what is circulating in the library. We can also use the material, the information that we get to determine when items are going out, what day of the week, what hour of the day. That helps us with our staffing models and making sure that we have coverage. We also use it to determine whether something has not gone out and is no longer relevant. So it's one of the things. So we do have a tremendous amount of information that we collect.
Maybe on the lower left, I'm surprised that electronic is 1%. Is that because?
Yes. You know, that's a great point. Circulation is defined as an item that goes out and comes back. We have, the point that I'm going to make, and that's an excellent question, John, is that there are certain things that do not go out and come back. They just go out.
They're virtual.
They are virtual. You get an article from a magazine. You download a music track. You download a magazine. You don't have to return those. Those are considered sessions, and we report those differently on our state reporting. So the circulation is strictly the ebooks that you see. And even at 1%, those numbers have grown steadily over the years. And I do, if you ever really want to, I think it's kind of probably boring to people who don't work in libraries. But we do watch those trends, which you know, how many physical audiobooks go out versus the downloadable audiobooks that go out. What types of, are they popular fiction? Are they nonfiction? Are they teen? Are they adult? And we use that to help us determine what to purchase.
Did I see something you guys put out an email? I don't know if it was through the friends or just in general distribution, that you were trying to encourage people to download an app so that you could access more of the books online, right?
Yes. We have two platforms for our ebooks. One is called OverDrive and the other is EBSCO's Always Available Ebooks. The OverDrive is an actual app that you can put on your phone, and it allows you to download both ebooks and audiobooks. That is a checkout check-in system, and they did just recently upgrade it. So there was an announcement saying this is an updated app.
So the idea of that is to get more people to utilize the collection electronically.
Absolutely. We do promote those material types of materials on a regular basis, kind of on a rotating basis, because we actually have quite a few. Before I get to those, just so you know, we've had our first year of mobile printing. That means that you can print from anywhere and send the print to the library and pick it up. We were averaging about almost 60 per month. I'm not sure whether that's going to continue or not. A lot of people were sending prints to the library because they didn't want to come sit at the place in your market basket. So now they can just come sit at the library and print it out. So I'm not sure what that will happen. But it is something that is helpful. We had over 9,600. And again, this is all in our temporary space. The numbers that you're seeing is in our small library. 9,600 computer sessions, about 186 per week. There are still a large number of people that only have smartphones. They don't necessarily have a computer or high-speed internet at home, and they do come to the library to use that. And Kevin Frilla was very helpful in helping us to get our wireless sessions. We do monitor it. This is all information that we're required to report to the state. We had about 58,000 wireless sessions. It could have been someone sitting at Liquor Junction looking, I don't know, doing it. But our wireless access points are on from 9 until 9 until 10 or something like that every single day. So you can actually come to the wireless and sit in the parking lot. We also have the virtual library, and to both John and Barry's point, we have over 30 digital magazines, including Consumer Reports. They get a lot, particularly Consumer Reports gets a lot of online use because you can actually search and do reports with that. We have over 3,000 downloadable audiobooks. The reason there's a star means that we can count that as a circulation. We have over 45,000 ebooks divided between those two platforms that I mentioned. We have a service called Freegal that gives you access to 7 million downloadable music tracks. I think it's from like 19 different studios. And you actually can keep that. You can download up to 3 per week. We also have things like Ancestry.com, which is incredibly popular right now, Tutor.com, which is a one-to-one online tutoring service, and Mango Languages. So those are all services that you can use either, like Mango Languages has its own app, so does Tutor.com. Ancestry.com is only for use in the library. We do have numbers and statistics on those. If you're dying to know, I can send you the information, but it is safe to say that all of those numbers have been going up over the last few years.
I'm not trying to say I would be dying, but I've got to believe that your industry is in the middle of a sea change in terms of going from printing on paper to storing electronically or virtually, and that's as much a measure of who your customers are.
Correct.
Right? You've got very smart. My 2-year-old grandson is able to now pull my daughter's phone out of her pocket, turn it on, and go navigate to his favorite YouTube flick.
Sure. Yep.
Amazing. So
it is, and I think interestingly though, they have done studies, that recent surveys have shown that students, and I believe it's high school and college, do often prefer to have the book to do a certain amount of research. So the textbook rentals and all of those things have not flown, have not just taken off the way people want to be able to do, like the online textbooks.
But the Kindles, the casual reading more.
Yeah, it's definitely there, but it's a little different.
I'd be curious in seeing how your business changes, you know, year to year, particularly over the next several, as you know, Kindles, all the...
And that does, we do have an increase steadily on those ebooks that people are downloading from OverDrive, and they are reading them on their Kindles. At the same time, interestingly enough, our circulation of physical materials has not dropped.
So, if it's in the circulation, that means it comes back?
Yes, you check out these books.
So the ebooks...
They are on your device.
Down to your device.
And then they're deleted.
They have a life.
They have a license.
Disappear.
They're digital.
So that you get to keep it for X amount of days?
Correct. Correct. And interestingly enough, and this is probably a little too much detail for right now, but it is important to understand, when we purchase a book, purchase 16 copies of a James Patterson book, we own that book. We can do whatever we want with it. We can burn it. We own that book. When we get our ebooks, we are leasing all of those books. We are required every year to renew them. They can take them away at any time. It's a very different and it's a very expensive model. And by the same token, Amazon can take away any book they have on. You as a consumer are only leasing that book. They have the right to take those books away from you at any time.
Any evidence that they would do that?
They have. It was a 2009 or 10, I think. No, it had to be later than that. But there was a book, and I feel like it was a classic. It was something like Catcher in the Rye. I don't know, something like that. And they actually did. They deleted it because there was a copyright issue.
The author, whatever.
Had not given permission for it to be sold as an electronic.
So that's a royalty every year, like when you know.
Yeah, it's not egregious, but there's no question. When you go and you say, oh, I can just buy this Kindle book for $7.99, why can't the library? The library pays $70, $80 for that book. And we don't always get, sometimes they're even limited, and they'll say, you can check this book out as many times as you want. Sometimes they'll say, you can only check this book out 12 times, and then you have to pay every time it gets checked out. So the licensing models for these things are still in flux. There's nothing permanent. There are several different vendors. Massachusetts is working on a statewide ebook platform, in which case they would negotiate it. There's always leverage, obviously, if you could do something at a state level and be working with some of these things. There are publishers who do not allow any of their books to be published either electronically or electronically to libraries. So there are certain books we cannot get. There are certain New York Times bestsellers we cannot get electronically, because the publishers will not give us permission.
So are those licenses right to uses, or are they pay for use? We pay
it depends. It depends. Each publishing house is different.
Okay.
Again, it's a really thrilling question. Those services, while important, are still just part of it. We do programming. We had 468 programs in fiscal year 16. And I put up there a translation of 1,800 hours, which is almost a full-time person. I think it's important to recognize also when we do programming, just like when you do teaching, teaching is not about just standing in the classroom for however many hours a day. You have to do preparation, you have to do planning, you have to get your materials, you have to grade. We do implementation of all these. So we may have a one-hour program, but on average, it's about 4 hours of work for every work, you know, probably anywhere from 3 to 5 hours, depending on the type of program that we do. And that may even be, you know, something that we outsource. So if we hire someone, we still have to negotiate the contract, we have to agree on the payment. Somebody's probably running out to Market Basket to get cookies and coffee. But we do have to do all those things. Not so much from fiscal year 16, but I wanted to show you the breadth of types of programming that we do. So some of these programs are currently going on. We had a wonderful community conversation. That was another cooperative program we did with the Interfaith Group, and I think it was at the UU Church with author Debbie Irving from Waking Up White. There's a book discussion and community conversation. We're doing a series on end-of-life care. We host the English Conversation Group. We had a class on Facebook for Business, Foreign Affairs Discussion Group, and the Author Day. We did do library tours for the Parker Middle School, grade 6. We were unable to do Coolidge. There was a cost affiliated to that, so next year we'd like to get a sponsor and be able to bring Coolidge into the library. Our standard Mother Goose lap sits. We had a program on college admissions. We have a sensory story time, and of course our summer reading program and story walks. So all of these programs are things that we feel contribute to the educational, economic, and civic well-being of our community.
This is all paid staff. None of this is volunteer.
To do programs? Occasionally we have a volunteer. I mean, if you would like to come in and do a session on whatever it is that you do when you're in your real life, then we would love to have you.
Please.
And we'll help promote it and help get people there. I will say the entrepreneurial series that we just kicked off with CrossLink is very popular. We do a lot. We try to work a lot with small businesses, hence things like Facebook for Business. Obviously, we work in the industry, right?
Actually,
we would really like to do a personal archiving series. Some of those programs are not able to do by a volunteer basis. So some of these programs do actually cost money. So, and we have no budget for programs at all. Every program that you see is either run by the library staff and the Cookies and Milk, and or if we have to have a speaker, those are supported by outside funding, either through the Friends of the Reading Public Library, sometimes the foundation, and also through external grants.
And Amy, I'm sorry, is there any connection between the town library and any of the school libraries?
Yes, we work with them. We generally try to do cooperative programs. We support the curriculum, and it's not just the school libraries. I would say we actually have a very good relationship with the schools. We work with the teachers. We provide a lot more with the elementary schools. They just simply don't have the resources,
right.
And
yeah.
So, you know, we'll do a deposit collection for, you know.
But it's casual. There's no formal. There's no...
They have meeting. I mean, we meet. They meet quarterly, I believe, with the media specialists, and they have one annual meeting.
Thank you.
A lot of that is driven by the media specialists' needs and availability. It's not something that we push on them. We ask them because, first of all, they can only meet specific times, but we want to make sure that we're serving their needs because we can supplement them. This is a common calculator. It was originally created by the Mass Library Association. It's available at the Chelmsford Public Library website. Who has sort of managed to upkeep the market values for things. It's a online calculator. You put in the number of things that, number of books you've circulated, it has a value. A children's book on average is about, a hardcover children's picture book might be $17, so they just have a whole placeholder in there. So in terms of the order of magnitude, even if you were to say their calculator was incorrect and it's really only half of that to buy a children's book, if you were to cut that $5 million in half, the town's investment in the library, which is currently $1.5 million, is more than double. So it's over 166%. This is what we do, and this is what we give you for your money.
What is ILL? ILL.
I'm sorry?
Middle of the left.
Yeah. What interlibrary loans.
Oh, thank you.
Little library lingo there, sorry. Interlibrary loans, and that's the process of getting the materials.
All right, thank you.
So. The building. The building is very ancillary to our budget, but the building project has been completed. There's just a few photos from our recent opening in October. We were closed for 6 weeks. To do this move, and I will admit that the work is still ongoing. We have people in there today hammering and sawing and gluing and nailing, painting, but it's lovely. We have seen an incredible uptick in use, which is why I'm going to get to the next slide. But before I did that, we get a lot of questions about the building and the funding, and that's an $18.4 million building, and that $18.4 million is, I actually don't sign off on any of that. That's all Bob and the project manager, Joe Huggins, they oversee that. Starting in 2015, we realized that obviously there were cost overruns and there were certain things that we would need to supplement. And we have been fortunate enough to be able to date, expend over $300,000 towards things that were either cut out or trimmed back on in the budget due to just unforeseen circumstances that cut into the hard construction, and that's nobody's fault. And I think if you talk to anyone who's in the construction industry, these things happen. So we were able to, I just gave you a quick breakout, I don't know if you can really see that, but by category, we have a certain amount that was actually project-related, about $280,000 that was originally in the project and dedicated to the project, and we were just simply not able to fund it through the project. So we found the funds. The trustees, the foundation, have all stepped up and really tried to work hard to find ways to fill these gaps. Some of them are enhancements, things that we didn't know that we needed, but that we realize now that we should have. And some of them are our operating expenses, new expenses that we have that, you know, if you buy a new piece of equipment, you have to maintain that equipment. So I also provided just a very quick breakout of where that money comes from. We do receive state aid by remaining certified. We do receive a small amount of state aid, and that will go to continue some of the ongoing costs. We do have gifts, and we do have a small amount of trust money as well. So I just wanted to pass that on. It's $300,000 to date, and we have about another $74,000 committed to things that are coming in and will be bringing in to supplement the library to make it up.
Amy, how much, I have to ask you because you brought it up, how much more do you think there is needed beyond this?
Well, this is the $74,000 that we know that that will be spent within the next year.
So you've already got that spent in your
yes.
head. But is, I know this is more building question for the trustees, but how much beyond that?
I would say not, I mean, that depends because some of that money is, some of that $74,000 is already dedicated to a specific thing. So for very specific equipment.
I see.
And then ongoing, would it be nice if I had an extra $50,000 a year for programming and enhancements and, you know, replacing, I don't know, getting a new snowblower. There are things to help John. You know, there's a lot more sidewalks now. I don't know what that number is, but I don't anticipate. I mean, if your question is, do we need anything capital? No, we shouldn't need anything capital for quite a while.
And then the second question is on the trust. What's the support annually that the trust provides the operating budget?
Nothing.
So this is a one-time.
And what? And that's been saved up over years.
Okay.
So the same thing with the state aid. There was a fair, you know, at least from Ruth's perspective, from Ruth's side, there was a fair amount of saving up of things because we knew that, you know, the building and circulation equipment and to display things and extra shelving, some of those nice things, and some of those nice thing haves and some of the need to have things, need to
right. Do you know the value of the trust fund, the
no.
principal and interest?
No, we have a number of small trusts, but they're all very,
right.
very small.
Thank you.
So that's not the library foundation?
No.
That's different.
No, that's different. These are just small, you know, somebody has bequeathed it to the library.
Okay.
And I'm sure they actually probably make, you know, the town accountant, like, go nuts because she's like, yeah, one more thing I have to report for Amy. But I appreciate it. Every little penny. So to your point, but not so much with the capital, the impact the building is having. I ran a quarter two of fiscal year 16 and against quarter two of fiscal year 17. So that's when we opened October, November, and December. We're busy. We have an increase in circulation. We have an increase in everything.
This is small building to big building or big to big?
This is small building to big building,
okay.
But I...
Okay.
If you look at our fiscal year 16 numbers, our numbers in our small building were, except for the actual room use, we still did the same number of programs, if not more. We just did them off-site. So the actual physical management of the rooms was not a piece. But the programming, the services, all of that, none of that really dipped a lot while we were in our small space, which either says, this is a really dedicated community, or it's a wonderful library, or both. So we were extremely busy in the temporary space. But what this does tell you is that we are busy. And you know, we had hopes of obviously increasing our staffing if there had been an override to accommodate a lot of this. However, we don't have that.
Just go back. When you say 150% patrons, you mean there's 2.5 times more people?
Those are new patrons. So on average,
people you've never seen before.
You know, people move out of Reading every once in a while.
Sorry, there it is right there.
Yeah,
on average,
we have a certain number of, you know, about 60, 70 people a month that come in and they're getting a new card.
This is fantastic news. Obviously, the point of the library is to increase usage, circulation, all of this. So these numbers are fantastic. Obviously, mm-hmm. The building's drawing them in somehow.
Yes.
Or
our staff, yeah.
And we expect this, hopefully,
to continue.
The engagement of the community in the library services is great.
we are very, very pleased with this, and I think we, in general, had very positive responses to the building, and it's actually been kind of fun to have people occasionally walk in and see something new, and they'll be like, oh, look at that, there's a new bench there.
The only thing here is you might separate activity and results. So things like room use is an activity, interesting, an indicator, but it doesn't
yeah.
tell you very much.
And I have a slide on meeting room use, actually, so I'll get to that in a minute. But it's an excellent question. It's a good point. But getting back to the summary, what the trustees have, and I'm glad they're here, this has been a little bit of a different process because we've had a lot of iterations on what-ifs. So we did end up, in order to come up with a 1.25, I think it says 1.3 in the munis, because it probably rounds up, but we have an increase of 1.8% in our salary line. In order to accommodate the busyness of the current library, and also in order to not lay off staff or negatively affect our benefited staff, we will be eliminating our Sunday hours. Sunday hours were added in fiscal year 2009. They started in October of 2008. They were essentially the last in, and they will be the first out in terms of hours. It was in direct response to need of the community, or not need, but I guess request from the community. It is a popular time to be open. However, it is only 3 hours. It is overtime. And in not having those hours, as I said, does not require us to affect anyone's weekly benefited staffing. It's very important to us, as much as we have a beautiful building, I still feel very strongly that our staff are our greatest asset. They walk out of the building every night, and I would really like to see them come back in every morning. So employee retention is very, very high on our list of priorities. By eliminating Sunday hours, we will be able to, I think, have a more positive experience. It is 60 hours a week that we are open. We are open on Saturdays from 9 to 5, and we are open 4 evenings a week until 9 o'clock. So we are open a large, you know, well beyond normal business hours. We will also be decreasing our expenses by 1%. Our expenses are only about 20% of our budget. We're going to move the materials budget down to 14%. It's currently at 14.5, 14.7, something like that. We think that this is something that we can bear. And what we're going to do is also pop up a little bit of money into our technology licensing and maintenance.
Where do we sit relative to the minimum, I'm gonna get the term wrong, the minimum amount of circulating materials or the purchase of new materials?
14%. The minimum requirement, and this is a minimum requirement, not a best practices standard, the minimum requirement is 13%.
So we're at 14.
And we're at 14.
14% of what? Total spend?
The overall municipal appropriated budget. So if we get $50,000 outside of that, we can use that to purchase materials, but it's not that 13% is what the town
budget.
Gives us. 13% of that somehow, somewhere, has to be done.
It forces you to kind of replenish and maintain.
It is a check and a balance. The minimum required hours and the minimum and the materials budget is so that a town cannot say, well, we'd like to fire everyone but just leave the building, or we'd like to get rid of our whole collection and just have a couple people working. So it's a check and a balance to make sure that the town is maintaining its side of the bargain. This is a breakout. It's all it does is in your munis handouts, salaries are there's no total for the salaries because the divisions are separated out and the expenses come out under administration. So it's a little more difficult to see the numbers that I pointed out to you. But this simply all it does is it tells you that we're going from a materials total of 14.49% to 14%. So it's a drop of about 0.5%. Sunday hours are swept back into some of the librarian hours. Do you have any questions about how that works?
So is that why we're seeing a reduction in most of the staff?
No.
From the Sunday hours or?
No, not at all. You're gonna see a big pop in the librarian lines for the children's librarians and the reference librarians. And those are because those Sunday hours, what's left from the 2.75% increase, what's left over is we had to put somewhere, so we were putting it into our librarian hours so that they could do more programs. It does mean that the work between, the support between Monday and Saturday will be less than. So we're not giving back money, basically. But we couldn't support the Sunday hours fully.
Right.
So.
Well, I did notice that yourself and some others are taking significant.
I didn't take a cut. I just get paid less than the previous director because.
Okay. Gotcha.
Man, transitions.
It's not a big number, but is there any synergy behind things like technology versus the library in the town in terms of using some of the resources on one side or using what we have differently?
Yeah, I mean, I think we use technology. We have somebody over there pretty much every Thursday, if not more than that. We do try to use that. I think Bob and I have talked about ways that we can kind of take some things out of our budget and put them into the general budget. We do have to be careful because the municipal appropriate, even if I were to be able to find, again, $100,000 that I could just give to Kevin Ferla and he could absorb it somehow into his thing, into his budget, the town must maintain an average of 1.25% over a 3-year period. So each year, you can either do it all at once and then do 0.00, or you can do 0.00, or you can do a quarter of 1.25.
What is that statistic, that 1.25?
The municipal appropriations requirement, what you give me this year.
Yep.
And the next year, what you give me this year has to be at least 1.25% over what the previous 3-year average is. And that is a state requirement. So you can't just suddenly cut the budget. So if you take fiscal year 15, 16, and 17, and you divide it by 3, and you add 1.25%, that is the minimum that you're required to give us. Now, last year we received something like a 3.6%. Honestly, that's going to cover you for a couple years, so it's not an emergency. But when we get to this year and next fiscal year, and who knows what's coming up with fiscal year 20, and you're doing 1.25 this year, and you go down to 1% next year, and if fiscal year 20 is even worse and we're going down to 5%, at some point you can't cut the library budget anymore because you're not maintaining the 3-year average of that percentage. Yep.
So you can never shut a library. You can never shut a library down.
Bingo. By statute.
Oh, wait. Let's be fair. Yeah. You can shut the library down and you can defund it.
Lots of bad stuff happens.
They go right.
And I'm assuming the state aid alone that you get doesn't cover that.
No.
That's very nice.
It's very nice. But
I think it's even more important to remember we have $5 million for the new building. We have to maintain a library for a certain amount of years. Otherwise, we have to pay that back.
Yes, they can ask for the money back.
It does, huh?
Yes, they do.
20 years?
That's 20 years.
That's kind of clawback if you don't maintain yourself.
But none of that spending is here. None of the building is
part of the accreditation.
Yes, yes. So, and just so you know, and even if the building, and I understand that some people that $5 million callback is very important, but again, the people in this town attended all of these programs. They checked out and borrowed and downloaded all of these materials. If we were to lose the certification, they would not be able to use.
I'm not suggesting. I'm just trying to understand your statement.
I just want to make that.
No.
I'm trying to understand your statement.
Okay. We're just pointing out. We love how the state, lumps things on us and doesn't like funding.
Yes, it's right. It's an unfunded mandate.
It is an
no
interesting
question.
Point of information. Sure.
Yes, but I will also say too that it is a small. We're 1.7% of the budget, and to go up by 1.25% every year, although we would obviously like to have more than that and could use it just for simply wages, is really not that onerous. It's not as onerous as many other, departments are required.
It's an increase of 1.4% over a 1% net. So yeah, I mean,
it's not that.
It sounds larger when you're using the numbers than
it's not.
The percentages instead of the real numbers.
Right, exactly. So thank you. I did also just want to let you know, meeting rooms, and this came up because of a lot of the discussions over the last couple nights. The trustees did update the policy in August 2016, and there is a plan to continue to review and update that policy on an annual basis, unless it's needed more frequently. What they reviewed were several different options, from no fees at all to increased fees and fees for including for-profit options. What they agreed on and what was voted into policy is to maintain the $10 per, I think it's a four-hour session, up to 4 hours, for nonprofit groups, $20 for Reading residents, plus any sort of custodial fees outside of the library hours that would incur. And they must, the activities must fulfill some sort of education, cultural, or civic need. There's a couple other things, the meeting room policy is a couple pages long. But I did want to point out room use. We went from having two rooms, this is why the numbers, as you said, John, are a little skewed. We only had two rooms in the old building. We now have basically four rooms that are available for the public to use. We have a total of seven spaces for the librarians to use for their programming. So to say that it was increased by 127%, well, of course it was, we have more space, so we can run more programs. So, we did have 58 non-library programs in the second quarter of fiscal year 2017. I provided a very brief list of who's using it. So we have Cub Scouts, Daisy Troops, Girl Scouts, Boy Scouts, Friends of the Public Library, obviously. We hosted some things for our Noble Consortium. The Northern Suburban Planning Council, Julie Mercier, had hosted a program that's considered a town event because it was sponsored by a department. Old South Methodist Church used us for a staff retreat. The Reading Antiquarian Society, a couple of our committees have been in there. A lot of sports group, Pop Warner got a place dirty, but we recovered. Representative Brad Jones has regular office hours there. We have an example of a resident using it. One of the RMHS reunion committees have been using it. We worked with Reading Public Schools to host a social-emotional learning conference, and the CPAC had a dyslexia program there as well.
Who is CPAC?
That's a Special Education Parents Association. It's part of the committee.
So religious organizations, no problem. Political organizations, no problem.
Yes, the Reading Democrats meet there regularly. It just has to have a cultural, educational, or civic purpose. And it needs to be nonprofit unless you're a Reading resident, in which case you can use it, but you have to explain why you're using it. So it could be like a college interview. It could be, you know, that kind of thing. I put the asterisk there because as much as we talk about fees and revenues, a large portion of the people who are using it are other town departments and groups that we wouldn't normally charge. So we would not charge the Reading Public Schools to use the space unless it was outside, you know, well outside library hours and incurred a custodian fee, in which case they'd have to do that.
Where do these proceeds go?
Back into the general town fund. They do not come back to the library.
Bob, I'm assuming that much like everything else with town when it comes to fees, the state ties us to our costs.
Yeah. Right. Don't worry, these fees are low enough.
Well below.
No. I'm just like curious.
You're right. Profits.
That's right. Kind of where I was going with it. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
There's no evidence.
To turn it into a cost of.
I also, just out of whimsy, did, and you don't have to read this.
Whimsy's good.
These are the libraries that are in our peer groups. It's the same libraries that we use for a lot of other things. It's, I mean, the towns that Bob had. Most of them do not charge anything for fees, for meeting room use, at all. And when I spoke to a couple different libraries, they said, wow, that $10 sounds a little bit more like a nuisance fee than a nuisance fee. I said, well, it's a fee, and we get it. So places that do charge, you know, there may be other reasons. They may only have two rooms. It may be that they're trying to reserve it for library use. But the majority of them actually have no fees. So I just thought you might find that interesting.
I see Andover, Belmont, and North Reading all allow for-profits and charge proportionally more.
Would
you consider revisiting that policy?
That's a question for the trustees.
Oh, we can take that off.
We talked about it, and we decided we didn't know
what the public use was going to be, and in the new building in the first year, and we chose to leave it this way for the first year to see what the use is like, and then reconsider.
So some of the rates on the prior slide were kind of more proportional, $50 to $100 for the room use, and I'm sure the profits would accept that. You know, it's $150 there for North Reading for 4 hours. It's $100 for Milton. It's $250 for Stone. So, you know, that's a 10x or a 15x on what you're getting now, so.
But to this point, I mean, philosophically, we want to make sure we are meeting the municipal demand and not, we don't want to be knocking out the Boy Scouts to make $250 on that.
But I guess you'd schedule it too, so you'd know in advance whether the time was booked and you could.
Yeah, a lot of these meeting room policies, and I didn't want to put too much information on this page, but including ours, do limit the number of times. In Andover, you can only use it one time per year.
A group.
Yeah. We allow up to 12 times. You know, you could have your monthly garden club meeting there.
Manage your house as you see fit, right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. We've been hosting a number of private book groups. People are willing to pay $20 to have their book group at the library.
I think that was, as I recall, looking at the renderings and, planning and the request of the community for a debt exclusion.
That was the intent.
This was one of the, I don't want to call it a selling point, but one of the perks back to the community that was offered. So this actually is following what was originally described, long before these rooms existed.
Yesterday when we were talking with the fire chief about sort of the fees generated from ambulance services, we discussed that there was basically a cost to his budget for basically having those kinds of services. And so, with that discussion, does it make sense, although these fees are minimal, that it does have wear and tear, there is a cost to the library to basically having these things. Does it make sense to set up some type of a revolving fund that has some of those fees go back to the library to maintain it, go for the funds? So, we talked about it with the fire department. It seems like it's the same type of thing here, again, on the table. I'm not suggesting it, but.
Yeah. Although, with the fire department, that does not go back to the fire department.
Yeah.
Right, but as their fees do, too. So, again, the fire department is going to, I'm sure, for $10 a night, we're not getting anywhere near what the fire department is bringing.
It's kind of a moot point to talk about revolving funds until there are funds. Yeah. So, yeah.
Bill, you had a question or comment?
Just a comment. In my many years down there, we did have at one time, I don't know how many revolving funds the town meeting said no more, because they had no control over it.
The library does currently have a revolving fund for funds and fees. It's used for
materials. Yeah, I know that. But, everybody and their brother years back had a revolving fund for one thing or another. The town meeting had no control over the money. And we just.
There's a way to shelter it.
They pretty much said no. Unless they had a good cause. I agree with that. We could use one in the cemetery. We could use a rollover guy. It's not about people over escape, so.
Okay, captive audience. Yes.
Hi, Jen Hillary. Please note I have no opinion in this question. I'm just curious what the history of fees are with regard to late books. I know that.
Yep. We do not have late fees, and we have not had them for a number of years. There are towns that still have them. The majority of them, many of them do not. It is considered studies have shown that it is a barrier to access. So when there are fines and fees, oftentimes the people who are most affected by it are people who really can't afford those fines and fees, number one, and you prevent them from coming back. We do live in a fairly affluent community where many people will say, I don't really feel like waiting 2 weeks for this book, so I'm just going to go buy it. And that's a luxury that not everybody in the community has. And so the fines and fees are a way, not having fines and fees. Actually, another study has shown, several studies have shown, that you actually get more materials back. People are much more willing to drop something off and when they know they're not going to get judged for their lateness. So oftentimes it's really just, and I think term nuisance fees that was used for the $10 during, that's what it ends up being, is it's
cost you more to collect it.
Exactly. They, in Reading, I know, and I wasn't here, because this was a number of years, I've been here 13 years, and it's before my time, they did a study, and the amount of time that it took to collect 20 cents from somebody, and they didn't have it, they, you know, now, if you have 20 cents, do you take a debit card? Can you take a debit card for my 20 cents? So what we do collect are, we still have our express collection, which is, you get it for a minimum, it's like a, you know, keep a book for 7 days, and if you don't bring it back, you have to pay 25 cents a day. Most people bring it back. And then we also have our fees for lost materials. So if you never bring a book back, you cannot check anything out to either pay for that and replace it. And that's why the revolving fund is specifically for replacements and things like that.
Two questions, Amy. How long is never?
What?
If you never bring it back, how long is
that? That means they never just come back. I mean, we've had books come back after 2 or 3 years.
But I'm just curious, what is never? I come in a year later, do I get to take material out?
Absolutely. As long as you either bring the book back or pay for it.
But if I don't bring it back, how long is never? When am I cut off?
You're just cut off. You just can't use it.
When?
Oh, 6 weeks. 6 weeks. I'm sorry.
Couple of months.
All right.
It's 6 weeks. It's 42 days. Yeah.
The second is, what's your loss ratio in terms of volumes? What do you think was the percentage, number of volumes that don't make it back?
I couldn't tell you that off the top of my head.
10%? More than 10?
No.
Less than 10.
No, we're struggling. So we purchase about, like I said, we get in about 12,000 items a year. We do not have a great plan for growth in view of technology. And we have to make sure that we have room for everything that we purchase. So
you said you're struggling. You mean you're not getting much back, as much as you would like back?
No, we're getting everything back. You can't get rid
Please
of stuff.
Take this.
Please keep it out early. No, I'm not. I'm just kidding. Please bring all your materials back. That's very important, so other people can enjoy them. But in general, it's a very positive thing, and they found. And you can read, you know, you'll read something about some library in California, and the person had $500. It was like an 8-year-old kid, and they never came back to the library for the rest of their life. And that is exactly the type of thing that we want to avoid. And we do try and promote responsible use of our materials.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions?
Is there any food in the library?
No. Food is allowed in the library, yes. We are a very open library. We do ask that you clean up after yourselves. We prefer tops and covers on things. Except in the history room. That's it?
Is that up and running now?
Put a Starbucks in.
Almost. Just brown, almost.
So will we be, I know there's some discussion, I don't know how it ended, or if it's ongoing. It may be, you know, either of those. But the fabulous town documents that exist in the basement,
mm-hmm.
are those scheduled to move?
No. That's why I would like to do the townwide.
Yeah, to be discussed.
Yeah, I think that...
I'm not trying to...
Yep.
No, I'm just...
Yeah. No, I appreciate your question. Archives and special collections are an interesting animal. First of all, the townwide preservation assessment grant that I would like to get is townwide, so it requires, you know, we should get the, you know, the churches, we should get the Antiquarian Society, Historical Commission. It should be everybody who has anything, the town clerk that has anything, and they do this assessment. At the end of the assessment, like anything else, you're going to get a plan and to say, by the way, if you have $1 million, this is how you're going to be able to keep this collection and hire 2 people, 5 people, or whatever to maintain it. They're going to give you an ideal situation.
I didn't hear anything.
We're going to give you an ideal situation
of something.
Of how to maintain this collection.
The bird of paradise.
And I think one thing, and I have had some people say, you know, like, gee, wouldn't it be great if you could bring all the blah, 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 blah. We do work regularly to digitize many of our materials. I mean, that's an ongoing process. And we apply for grants and we get funding to do that. And the reason why you digitize with any of these materials, these special collection and archives, the most important thing is to get them indexed and cataloged so that people can know that you have the information. A second priority might be to digitize them so that people might actually be able to look at them. Digitization is not a permanent preservation tool. There's nothing in this world. Even digital archives have a life. So there's no permanent tool. The main goal of all of these is so that you actually don't have all of your books and papers out on display for people to touch and look at and breathe on. So some of the things that come back from something like a townwide preservation may not have the answers that some people who ask these questions are looking for, which is I would really have to have a beautiful building with all of the books and the records beautifully displayed so that our children can come in and look at that. And I have worked in archives and special collections, and oftentimes...
Sounds like a museum, not a library.
Well, there you go. So, but the important thing is the cataloging and indexing of that so that when you go back, you know exactly. And when we get into Bill Brown's house, and we get all his stuff, and we know that he has that one copy of that one year
apparently
book that nobody else
too.
Has. You know, I said townwide.
If you want.
And unfortunately, the other thing is that they will also tell you the things that you do not need to keep and that are not not as much of a priority of certain things. So I think, as with any study that you do, whether it's a building study or you know something for an early education, early literacy center or whatever, early education center, you do the study, you ask the professionals to come in. The grants are usually about, Beverly just got one, I think it's starting this year, I think it's like $25,000. You do the study, and then you take the results written by the professional, and then you have to decide what is the what's the temperature for this community? How much are we willing to dedicate? What will you fund?
Are we have we applied? Are these grants?
They're every year. They're every year, and it's usually a rolling date around November. So.
And we've applied or will apply.
We would like to apply. I would like to apply.
Bob, did you have a comment?
Yeah, we're kind of jump ahead to something you'll see in either February or March. Amy and I only talked about it briefly. I've talked about it a little more with the town clerk. The other night we started talking about boards and committees and commissions. Working together. One of my proposals to you will be to put, I think it's six, there are six boards and committees that should have their hands on this project or a project like it. And again, some people misunderstood the comments the other night to be we're eliminating the boards and committees. The idea is to make them more efficient and effective. So one of the working groups that I will propose to you on an informal basis, not an ad hoc committee, is to put people from six boards and committees together on a historic project. And specifically have historic documents in the town, whether public or private, so Bill Brown's house is a target. just to be, first of all, inventoried. You know, we don't really know what we have. If you go back, I'll use his name. Ben Nichols had a lot of stuff in his house before he moved to Pennsylvania. That, had he not donated a lot back to Town Hall, would have been lost forever. We ought to at least understand what we have before we decide what should we do with it. So that's one of the examples of something you'll see again in a month or two.
Any other questions? So John, did that answer your question?
It does, for now. I'm so interested in this, and I'm glad that we're taking other steps to take a look at things that we might.
It's
if you've ever had the chance to go downstairs in the town hall and look at those documents, they're spectacular.
Probably going to fall under a nice to have for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah, I get that.
So, all right, Jeff.
Thanks.
And we should probably just say, this is the first time you were here, that and to the trustees, that's a tremendous building. It's something that I think we can all be proud of for a really long time. If folks haven't been in, go see it. It's great.
And I would invite all of you to
you do need the actual budget.
Good. That's great. Definitely.
Careful if you invite us, we'll show up. We don't want to stay past 9 o'clock because we don't
want to
build, though.
That's Joe.
That's
not my
building. The piece here.
Yeah.
We're set, huh?
Have a good evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
We're here to talk about the Public Works budget this evening. To recognize my assistant Public Works Director, Jay Consellas, here, who's you've been here like a year and a half now as the assistant, and does a great job. I just want to recognize her as being a key manager, part of the management team. Here's a current org chart. As you can see, I have myself as the assistant director, Jane, and we have the various divisions: engineering, water and sewer, highway equipment maintenance, parks, forestry, cemetery, each with supervisors for each division. I will say, make a comment that it's almost like we've come full circle. When I first started almost 8 years ago, one of my main marching orders were to think about succession planning and how that's going to all come about. And actually, we're in a position now where come in 1st of June, all supervisors have been replaced. So I'll have a assistant director, 1, 2, 3, 4, all 5 supervisors in public works within the last 3 years will be have changed.
Yep.
And that's, as I say, kind of a success in the succession planning part of it, where we had people, for the most part, again, one still to be filled in June. That's the Parks, Forestry, Cemetery supervisor. But the rest of the positions did come from within, where people put themselves in positions through training and course study to move up. So it's worked out really well. I think you have a question.
Yes.
Is there going to be any overlap on that position?
That's the plan. Is actually the plan is to really start looking at the replacement for Bob immediately.
Yeah.
I want to get that posted and out, and definitely have a transition period.
Because he's got a lot of knowledge, I'm sure.
No question. 28 years he's been here. I think
he's 28.
The other thing, it's all start on the org chart. We do have representation here from the three committees, the boards that we work with, the Public Works, we have the Trails Committee, and we have the Town Forest Committee, and of course the Cemetery. We do provide staff support to Cemetery. Bob, the supervisor, Bob Keene, does attend those meetings on a monthly basis. And also, as you know, in the budget, the actual budget, there's a line item of $1,000 for both the Trails and Town Forest Committees that are in the it's in the administration public works budget, but it's their access for their funds. And they use it for various projects over the course of the year. The next slide is just kind of an analysis of the current budget. Went through not a lot of changes, not a lot of differences between 17 and 18. As you can see, the under wages, the overall wage is going up 1.38%. Some of the specifics behind that. Do have a decrease in the town engineering wage section with the town engineer and the civil engineer due to the change in staff, where incumbents went out at a higher rate and the new people come in at a lower rate, so you've got some savings there. As the board knows, we did talk about in the highway division under wages, we are losing one long-term seasonal in highway. And actually, if you think about it, with the override, one of my positions that was going to be added to the budget was an additional highway laborer. So in a sense, I'm almost losing like two positions in the highway. The effect basically is going to be specifically during the summer months. We have a lot of vacation time where people are out. It's going to limit my ability to put together two crews at highway. Most of the time I can do that, but obviously that's more efficient to get more work done. But with that position leaving, and again, due to people with 4 or 5 weeks vacation and so forth, that's going to be a problem. And a lot of times, I'm only going to be able to get one crew out there on the highway. So that is one of the ramifications from that position, as well as potential one full-time that we were going to receive if the override went through. You see in the cemetery and the parks and forestry, there are increases there. Again, that's based on a change in the supervisor position for Parks, Forestry, Cemetery, give us a little flexibility in that hiring process. Obviously, it's kind of a unique position to have one supervisor over those three separate entities. Although it's interesting, Wakefield has the same basic structure as in the supervisory structure of Parks, Forestry, Cemetery as one person. So, so there are some examples out there, but that gives us some flexibility going forward to if we have to make some adjustments in that. Wages in the cemetery division. The as far as expenses, again, actual expenses are down 2.94% through the divisions. We have a couple small increases in street lights, street signs, and sidewalks, which is kind of offset by a decrease in the fuel budget. That's the area that obviously some unpredictability with fuel, but in the last few years, I've had some surplus there, and I think 50,000 was the amount. I think we adjusted budget for FY18 in that area, which I still think gives us some flexibility unless things really go anywhere.
Jeff, can I ask you a question about street signs? How come we went from those beautiful purple signs that everybody could read at a distance to the ones that you, it's a good thing you know you're in Reading because you wouldn't be able to read the ones that have the
upper, lower.
You're talking about the ones on West Street?
Yeah. West Street and also, you know, Woodman Street.
Yeah, those were, again, based on, because it was a state project, those are the new MUCD coded signs that.
Well, the modernization.
Right.
Exactly.
And that's.
It's the same guy.
That was.
The modernization.
It's just the same guy that painted the lines in the river. <That's
right. laughs> You know, the signs, reflectivity and the design, that was part of it. The new regulation. That's why they went up as they are. I mean, I still have the old signs tucked away, but.
I asked him to keep them.
He did.
Once they leave, can we slap them back up?
Exactly. Once the project is done.
Exactly. The project, I have a listing of the projects that, with the status, and we're like 90% through the Westview project. Once that is done, probably in the spring, we've got some punch list items. That's us.
Go back.
Yeah.
Does the new LED lights having any effect on the question of street lighting?
Yeah, it's they've replaced a number of them. It's the actual street lighting account is in good shape. You know, the actual street lights. This is for more of the repairs and some maintenance and some of the other lights.
I guess I'm surprised, Jeff, if you look at your budget for street lighting of 190K, it's broken up into 18K for maintenance, 12K for traffic light electricity, 155K for electricity for the street lights.
Right.
But, you know, my street is now all LED. That's shown a consistent trend upward, despite the fact that the lights are consuming 90% less electricity. That doesn't make any sense to me in the face of it. We should see a downward trend in streetlight consumption. The town's going to be done in 2 more years, or a year and a half.
That's my understanding.
So I would expect, if that's just street lighting, I would assume that would drop by more than.
It's possible.
Yeah.
I don't know why, but why is it up? Because last year, according to this, it was at 118K. Year 2 years prior to that, 127, 123 for 3 years running. Now we're up to 155 in an environment where we're using less.
I can answer that because I spoke to the general manager of the light department, and this is based on a conservative forecast of what their actual costs or prices they would pass along.
Oh, this is a pricing change, not a usage change.
This is a pricing change, and the consumption change is still not certain enough to be sure. We have, I don't remember the exact figures, but over the last 5 years, at least 3 times, we've actually decreased this budget. So the budget used to be 200,000, now it's 150-something thousand. So there's likely another notch down to be coming. But we were. It was really kind of new territory where, when this started, we didn't know what the usage would be, and because the general manager has warned us about much higher increases than in the past, we left it a little bit high.
I guess your calendar year to date is 60, so double that, you're at 120.
Yeah, that could be 25 too high. There's no question. Yeah. But the other caution here is, this is one of those unusual lineups voted by town meeting all by itself. So if you don't have the money, he can't just use other money. You'd have to go to FinCom or do some kind of an emergency thing.
Street lighting is a thing.
Well, it's in with a couple of things, so.
Oh, I still remember that as well.
Yeah, it's one of those, it's a combination of cost. By 20th. It's tucked in.
Similar to the snow budget, which is, again, level funded for next year. And the trash recycling contract is based on the contract we have in place. Last year, it's the second year of a 10-year deal that we signed with JRM, and that reflects the cost. Just a quick item on the snow is, when I first came 8 years ago, I know we had a program, we were kind of bumping up the snow and ice budget every year to try to get close to the 10-year average, I think. Yeah. And we did that for a number of years, the 10-year average.
Then it stopped snowing.
Oh,
I shouldn't have said.
So, Jeff, generally speaking, in the trash and recycling, there's a portion of that that's recycling, there's a portion of that that's pickup, and then a portion is
disposal.
Right. So you have a rough idea how those break out?
I have a slide.
Oh, good. Okay.
Talking about the difference. Actually,
before you go down,
the recycling and the collection program.
Back on the snow, are we owed any funds from the state for past 4 years?
I think it's going to say.
Chief Jackson can answer that question.
Oh, just got notified,
Chief.
2015, I just got notification.
Yeah, I got a packet today from FEMA. It's taken at least 432 hours of Chief Burns' life. We've gone through at least five FEMA inspectors. This is from 2 years ago, it was winter, they still haven't paid.
We just received, yeah.
But if we all live long enough, they may.
And that's the fence.
This is the fence.
Exactly.
Drain the swamp.
The next slide, I wanted to break out just with the board on, these are two line items in the highway that are, we really watch closely for obvious reasons, the equipment maintenance, the outsourced repairs. When I first came, both these line items were in trouble. And I think it was my first year, it was March, and I know we're doing the budget reports, we're running out of funds, and went to the supervisor at the time, said, well, don't worry, town meeting always, we know that, town meeting always appropriates money and puts X amount of money in, and it was in the order of $75,000 sometimes. And, you know, meeting with Peter and Bob, obviously that's not a good way to do business. If you have the cost, you've got to come up with it. So, and largely what we have done is we've kind of built that cost up, those line items up over the last few years. The equipment maintenance actually was behaving pretty well the last few years. We had a very small deficit at the end of the year. The outsourced repairs, similar scenario, although we FY16 we have had more of an issue, although we decreased that budget slightly that year starting out. But you see by the impacts at the bottom, some of the things that really also drive this equation. The parts increase, we're averaging 5 to 7% per year. Townwide, we've added an average of 2 to 3 additional vehicles per year. Each new vehicle needs inspections and maintenance. Again, this comes out of these accounts. Some auto and truck manufacturers require now their own diagnostic equipment that needs to be updated annually. Equipment is being more specialized, fire trucks and special tools, lifts to repair. Anytime you have a specialty equipment or repair a vehicle, be it an ambulance or a pump or a ladder truck, that drives the equation up. The commercial stickers have increased 300%, believe it or not, from $29 to $150. 90% of the public works vehicles are commercial. Plows are being added to most pickups when we purchase them to increase our use and flexibility, obviously for plowing, and but it does add wear and tear on the trucks. We pick up in this account. And then annual subscriptions to different repair and technical information continues to increase. So in spite of all that, I still think we've been, as you see, each year we've been monitoring it, and we're obviously much, much better shape than in days gone by.
Jeff, this is all materials, right, and expense. It's
yes.
Not wages.
Yes.
This is parts.
Yep.
So, Jeff, would you say your capital is in good shape? We're maintaining the equipment that we have. We're replacing
absolutely
the old stuff.
One of the reasons why this isn't really going out more is because we've got a really strong capital program. I mean, we get vehicles, you know, once they hit a 10-year life cycle or $100,000, it's kind of a guide on. But again, we sit down with the mechanic every year and see what's listed in the capital and what is it. Is there something that makes sense to repair this year? Or should we put it off a year? And we go through that every year. But basically, because we've had such a strong capital program and equipment replacement program, that really is not as in good shape.
How many vehicles total are represented here?
What's
how many
that?
Different vehicles or machines
right.
or?
Everything.
Total, 100, 200, 300?
Vehicles.
How many pieces of equipment are on that board?
About 120, 125, something like that.
And each of them, I presume you have on some sort of calendar for maintenance and?
We have a software program that every vehicle is programmed in so we know when it's due for service. Because remember, we also do not just public works, but we do the fire department, police department, school van. We do all the vehicles in town, so.
Do you RMLD?
No. I don't know what the other than them.
So the average is?
RMLD gets fuel for us.
Fuel.
Not the vehicle.
So you're spending $3,000 a year average on a piece of equipment to maintain it.
But that's all in labor, everything.
Right? That's all parts.
Right.
Well, the outsourced is labor.
That's true. And the outsourcing is on surge? You don't have the time or the people or just specialty?
You don't have the expertise mostly, right, for outsourcing.
It's an expertise thing or you just don't have the people?
I don't have the expertise, especially with some of the real specialized equipment, especially the fire department. And once you get past warranties and once you get past all that initial purchase, years,
the mileage will vary,
much more expensive.
So here's the eye chart.
Yeah, this is.
Yeah, yeah, cut some slack on this.
You have to make that big.
Jeff, do you have a handout?
Just go up to the top.
Just up zoom it.
The plus sign there.
What I thought I'd do was run through some of the major capital programs we have. Obviously, you know, we've got the day-to-day activity department with the maintenance and things that happen on a regular basis. But these are projects that, capital projects that either a couple of have been completed or are in the process of being completed. And I just have to run through them quickly if I can. Phase B water main capital improvements, that was completed actually this past year. Replaced approximately 5,600 feet of water main as part of the townwide water capital improvement program. Also included with Salem Street or with Linden Street. The NWRA, Northern High, Northern Intermediate High 36 pipeline is under construction now, as we know. Began spring of 2016, anticipated to be completed in the fall of 17. Approximately 7,600 feet of 36-inch main has been installed to date, making the project approximately 80% completed. West Street, we're all over the West Street construction project, we're about 90% there. So there's some additional traffic signal timing finalization needs to be done, some landscaping, some punch list items, but again, that's looking to be completed this coming spring. West Street and Bachelor Road pump station replacements under construction. Bachelor, the pump station is under construction, will be done sometime probably end of January. Then it'll move to West Street sewer station, and that'll be completed hopefully by sometime by the end of February. These are a couple of in-house design projects. Bond Street drainage is currently under design with anticipated bid in April of 2017. Project will include approximately 175 feet of roadway construction and regrading and modifications to the existing drainage system. Got a problem down there for years with the drainage and runoff. This is going to address that issue. Similar with Grove Street, main and drainage improvement currently under design. With anticipated bid March of 17, project will include replacement approximately 1,000 feet of old 12-inch cast iron water main with new 12-inch cement ductile line installation and new drainage, including catch basins as well. Town has responded to numerous water main complaints and breaks over the years in this area. Approximately 500 feet of new drainage pipe will be installed to help improve the localized flooding issue in the area. That's again, that's been an ongoing problem. Main Street and Mill Street, water main cleaning and lining under design. Currently anticipated construction 2018. Project will include cleaning and lining approximately 15,000 feet of water main located on Main Street, running to from Salem all the way to Mill, and Main Street to the town line. Also, Phase 9 sewer INI cured in place project. Coming anticipated bid in January and by the end of this month with construction to follow the spring under contract with CDM Smith to provide engineering services for the town. So ongoing, it's a part of the ongoing sewer INI program that's that town has in place. The project will install approximately 24,000 feet of Jordan line piping.
Quick go back on the Batchelder Road, yep. Jeff. There was I got a couple of emails from the community on
Yeah.
The duration of that, is that, that's now completed?
Bachelor Road, it's almost completed. It'll be completed by the end of, by the end of January, hopefully.
It was necessary to wall off one side of Batchelder just because of the magnitude of the
exactly.
project?
Exactly.
Did it take longer than anticipated, or was that?
No, it was a little delayed in, for a number of reasons. We had some issues with some utilities relocating some of the holes in the area and some other issues that kind of out of our control, but it delayed the project a little bit. Regarding the, I think you know, the board didn't receive, we responded to that, and
we got a couple.
And we, in fact, this last storm, we made sure that whatever issue it was icing,
yeah,
road, so
yeah,
took care of that.
And the trucks had to go back up.
Right.
Street.
I think all the way down and go from there. We did speak with the residents there as well. So.
Okay.
So Jeff, on that topic, so when a project like that happens, and I'm glad that you were able to contact that resident and straighten that out. But when that happens like that, where a road that is a kind of a circular road, that's got an in and out to it instead of a end to end, obviously when you had to block it off, it changes a lot for a lot of people.
Right.
How do we communicate to them? Is that, we send them a letter, do we send them a, what do we do?
We do a number of things. We do actually go door to door in this particular case. We do notify them individually. We have it on the website. We do a Everbridge notification.
Yeah.
Those are at least three specific ways that we do contact them.
But we don't mail them anything?
Not specifically, no. We leave notices door to door, and then we also,
okay.
As I said.
So there is a, so it's hand delivered mail. So you try to talk to them, and if they're not there,
right.
They get a flyer that says, this is what we're going to do. Because I do think that's important.
Yep.
If I could just add on that, the tricky part of that is, you know, in a morning, a schedule might change, especially if it's a contractor that we hired because of weather, or maybe they're just busy somewhere else and they don't feel like showing up.
Yeah.
So the communication is never perfect because some of it's really out of our control to schedule the work.
Yeah.
So they kind of do the best they can.
Okay. I bet everyone would be happy when the Old West Street project is the last of the bunch was done.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Continuing on just with some of the capital, we got our road program upcoming. We'll be going out to bid shortly, and these are the roads that are on list for the 2017 program. We're looking at approximately 15 streets, $1.2 million in cost. Just as a side note, in 2014, we road repairs included 2.9 miles from 2014 to the 21 streets. In 2015, 4.8 miles. This is not on the chart, but it's additional information. 2015, we did 30 streets, 4.8 miles. 2016, last year, we did 5.2 miles, 28 streets. And the bottom line is, in 2012, our PCI, which is our pavement condition index, was 71%, which is okay. It's, you know, it's upper middle, but it's okay. But since then, as of right now, we're in the area of 78 to 79%. And if you include this program on top of that, so we're probably around 80%, which is very good.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're talking about 100% where every road in the whole town is brand new, and you kind of back off from there, that's kind of how
the equation works. It could never be at 100% by the time you get there.
Absolutely not. So really, 80% is very good. In fact, I think I'm looking to have. I don't believe so. I mean, and it's the town's credit. Between the Chapter 90 and the town money for roads, it helps a lot. I mean, there's a lot of communities that unfortunately just have Chapter 90 money and the towns don't, you know, come up with the additional funding for road repair. But
we're
very fortunate.
Back to the capital plan.
Right.
You know, it does seem like it's all about planning because you don't get to these kind of levels of completion without it.
Bob, this might be a question for you. Main Street, South Main Street specifically. I know there's always a lot of chatter and talk about that road and that condition, but I know we're waiting on that for certain things, correct?
Yeah, that's a state road, so complicated answer.
Yeah, it is. I mean, there's been all this work that's been going on. Obviously, with all the gas main work and our water work and so forth, and I think originally, it was potentially on the list to do, but
I was just gonna say
like a year or two ago. But I mean, it's still, obviously you're not gonna do it while all this other work was going on. They want to make sure everything is done, and then of course, the MWRA, they're a piece of that action, and also Hopkins and Main, that intersection, we're looking at having that done. So they don't want to do anything until that is done. So basically, it's on the list to be done at some point once hopefully things are.
Will South Main be affected at all with our rating?
That section, no. It all goes the other way.
Yeah.
It goes the other way.
Are any of the streets that are up there, out of curiosity, I forget how many, it was more than one, recent conversions from private ways?
No.
I forget how many streets we included.
Yeah, they were all in good shape.
Yes.
We did last year, last April.
Yeah.
Some of these.
Up by the new school.
Right. Some of these are off of one of the, did Minor Street last year. Some of these are the side streets off of Minor, which you don't kind of get beat up and really they need to be done.
Yeah, Minor Street's great. I love that.
And then we have a couple of, you know, between Salem and Forest. Those are you know, big projects, so that's going to eat up some of the money. So
and a lot of through traffic there.
Right,
too.
Right. And so it's, you know, so that kind of eats into the chunk of the money. But it's, as I said, we're very fortunate that the town has been able to fund some of that.
I'm sorry, yes, Bill.
And what road be, being done because of complete nagging, right, Jeff?
We've got to find out where your house to get all that stuff out of.
It's probably because of DPW records in there too, probably. Just a couple, just to finish up, get the three other projects that actually the board is involved in. This one, we actually had a meeting on this. We are under contract with Samson to provide engineering services. We got in a water tank, painting a water tank.
Yeah.
We get the presentation. We did receive a analysis from Weston and Sampson regarding the life cycle of buying, you know, building a new tank versus repair and maintenance of the current one. Also, the issue about the cell tower, that's still being discussed. So at some
that's
point,
that's still under negotiation.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was a great presentation. Yeah. Really explained a lot about what's going on, what all the ins and outs of that.
And again, we are, Bedford went through a very similar scenario with their water tank, and actually they put up a cell tower, and a lot of similarities between there, what we're going to do, so I've got some kind of guide to look at there too, so I've got some information.
Yeah, that was part of the presentation too, right, with Bedford, yep. What they did in Bedford.
Right. A couple other projects, again, are ongoing. We're under contract to initiate a unidirectional flushing program. We flush the hydrants every year. This is a little different program that was recommended by Weston Sampson as part of our water master plan. And also the GIS implementation integration. After completing the utility mapping, Public Works and IT have started to integrate some mobile computers and work crews. Some mobile apps, multiple apps have been created to help facilitate operations of water, sewer, highway divisions. And now the supervisors have mobile apps they can use out in the field to be able to, you know, pull up to a water main and know exactly where the pipe is and where the connections are and so on and so forth. It's been a great help. I'd like to expand that to like the forestry department where they go out and be able to see right in the field if this tree is located in public or private and be able to make some determinations. So it's going to be a, that's going to be a help.
Jeff, this is the second time this week we've heard about GIS mapping. Fire department had talked about a program to put newer handheld rugged PCs in the hands to help better identify locations on the street. Is there any connection with what you're doing here where the same system could be used, perhaps? I don't know.
Yeah, I think there is. I mean, I think between the...
Do we need two of them, or can we get by with one of them, is the question.
Yeah. No, I think there's this. There's a lot of... Between GIS coordinator, engineering, there's a lot of coordination between the two, but I think...
I mean, they don't want to look at trees, they right. want to look at buildings, but I mean, is there any, can the basic, do we need two separate systems with two separate maintenance contracts and two separate subject matter experts?
No, it's just, Kim has different layers of GIS.
It's the same data, okay,
yeah.
Fine.
Yeah, I think it's the same, it's just okay. A different, you know, right. Yeah, additional information.
And the next question on the thing above it, why is it since, you know, the pipes have been on the ground since 1930, how is it we need now the modeling and the maintenance program? We just never had them before?
Right.
We didn't know what we had in the ground.
Well, no, we had, we're talking about
the flushing
program
and the hydraulic modeling.
The flushing is a different approach. We be flushing every year, you know, the water mains to basically cleanse the piping and any rust that's accumulated and flush it out the system and improves the water flow and also safety for hydraulic pressure. By doing a unidirectional, everything's going to be flushed the same direction. In other words, it's going to be all flow is going to be going the same direction.
I get that, but why are we modeling? Because we just don't know what's in the ground?
Yes. This is a different switching gears. This is, we talked a little bit about this before with the current rubbish collection program. You can see the totals for FY 14, 15, and 16. It's been pretty steady, around 30% with total recycling. And the first 6 months of this year, actually, it's pretty close, it's about 30%, which is exceptional for a community. In fact, the December's recycling was almost 36%, which is the highest we've ever had. And for a community that has, it's the highest or one of the highest recycling rates, any community does not have a pay-as-you-throw system. There are a couple of ones that have their pay-as-you-throw you know, with the incentive program, I think Gloucester is in the upper 30s and it's got the communities. But for communities that don't have that program in place, 30% is very, very good.
Look at the growth.
The more the recycle, the less you're paying for disposal and the more money that you're saving in the long run. And this all started basically once we started enforcing the mandatory recycling back in, that was 2012, maybe it was a while ago. But that's really a program that worked out really well. As you know, 2012, I think we received an award for recycling, municipal recycling year award. So that continues to be a very strong program.
I'm amazed at the bottom right corner. That's a 3% basis increase per year. It looks like 1% on the total, but it's 3% on the basis amount.
Right.
That's amazing. Yeah. You're still seeing, it's still improving.
Yeah, it's very, very consistent.
This doesn't include Christmas trees, of course.
Yeah, don't forget bottle caps.
The last slide, I think is, I'm looking for some discussion with the board. What I did is sat down with the supervisors and we looked at some potential areas that things that we're doing now that the committee is probably aware of. I don't think they're aware of the cost, but things that we, as we go forward, things maybe we have to think about, let's say maybe not doing, but either just looking at and making some informed decisions. And that's why I think, I mean, the first one we've talked about before, I think, in meetings. When I first came, my marching orders were we do snow removal after every storm. Every six, 8 inches of snow, we do removal downtown. And for my first number of years, that was, and we were actually up until this year, we're still operating under that mantra. But you can see the cost, $24,000. Now we're talking about crews coming in at, you know, 9 o'clock at night, going till 6 o'clock the next morning. A dozen of my guys with vehicles and equipment.
We've got
night-hour period from 9 at night till 7, 6 o'clock.
And what we're talking about
with the cats and the
everything. Loaders.
Sidewalk. We're doing
everything. All the downtown area. Removal. This is removal. Just removal.
Not the streets.
No. This is the sidewalk. It's a street. It's removal from the sidewalk in the streets downtown.
So you can have parks.
Basically, you can park. Right. Basically. I mean, the Bobcats will come in early, push everything out into the street to make sure it's loaded up, and then the blower will come in. And if you've ever seen that the blower, that Sakai blower in action, you can fill a 10-wheeler in about 40 seconds. I mean, so it's really, they do a lot of... They do a lot of work in that period of time. We do remove a lot downtown, we do it on Haven Street, we do all the piles, all the parking lots, CVS, Town Hall, this building. So it's a lot.
How much of that is private property that we're doing? Is that all public property?
So do we clean? So the sidewalks in front of the businesses get pushed into the street.
Down to the churches. We make a windrow and we take everything up.
I'm trying to figure if this is practical or not.
Just
it doesn't sound like
as an example, as a side note, I think here's a good example. This last storm, we had 6-7 inches of snow. So what I did, I came in that Sunday the next day, and my water sewer supervisor, Peter Isabel, he coordinates the nighttime removal process. And we rode around and we basically looked at all the piles, all the parking lots, all the areas. And because of the type of snow it was and the amount, we decided not to do a full blow removal. So what we did is I had his crew come in at midnight and they worked till 6 a.m. We did all the parking lots, all the piles. We did the depot area. We picked up some key intersections that we did. We did a little neatness here and tucking here. And it came out, I think, very well. I mean, I think it was a different approach based on a number of factors. It was the type of snow, it was a light, fluffy snow,
right.
But also, look at the weather forecast. It's going to be 50 degrees, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, it's going to go.
Right.
I mean, so I guess what I'm saying is going forward, I think it would make sense to look at these individual situations as they come up.
And well, it must work because we didn't hear about it.
Bingo. I received no emails and no phone calls. I don't know if the board did, but it's, and again, it was a number of factors, you know, the forecast being one, you just, but if it was 10 inches of snow and it was going to be 0 degrees for 3 or 4 days, another storm coming in, and I mean, that would have been different. But this particular instance, I think it's...
So number one, you're not talking about holistically discontinuing. You're talking about making a judgment call along the terms you are.
Exactly. And just so you know, as opposed to $24,250, what we did cost us $5,900.
Wow.
So, you know, it was just my guys and equipment. So, you know, overtime and equipment.
Yeah.
So anyway, it was...
Any rough idea? Because I know in a lot of towns, including Boston, for example, business has to clear its own walks. I mean, that's pretty standard in most communities, but not in Reading. So, you know, I'm guessing it's a little hard to figure out what the cost of that portion of it is because you're doing it all together. But it's interesting to note that that's something we do, that literally almost no communities do that for their business owners.
Not on a regular basis. I mean, commuters will do it, like Wakefield will do it maybe two or three times a year. When I was in Gloucester, we used to do it. I used to do it, you know, when once the top of the meter was covered, I used to do it. But a lot of communities do it two or three times a year once it gets to a point where it gets
And they have meters.
Right.
That's
right.
Exactly.
That's right. Yeah. So
what business areas are done then today?
Downtown, Main Street, all the way down Haven Street, all around the depot area.
But the sidewalks are public.
Right.
So what's private?
Private in terms of?
The town is responsible for the sidewalks anyway.
Oh, right.
So
that's not true.
Yeah, no, if you're a business.
Not for snow removal.
No.
Snow removal.
No.
But I mean, the thing is, what are they going to do? They're going to shovel it and they're going to put it in the street. So where else are you going to?
Well,
I mean,
they're lucky. Unless
they're not suggesting not do it.
Yeah, I
know. Just say it's, you know, there you think about the things that get done and the fact that there's a cost.
We talked about cases where there was a disparity between costs and what we were charging for fees. This is a case where you're doing something that has a cost and it is a fee of zero.
Right.
Correct.
Right. Some of the other items that, again, just these are things to think about. I mean, we have a, you know, eliminate the shade tree account. I mean, rely on donations and
is this the bags around the trees, the green bags? Is that what that is?
Okay. The annual salary cost for Saturday hours at the recycling at the garage. Discontinuance of the Saturday operation. Hours for recycling waste oil, styrofoam, electronics. If eliminated, available hours will be Monday through Friday, 7 to 3. Because above and beyond that, basically right now, every Saturday from 9 to 1, we take waste oil, styrofoam and electronics.
This is not your, like, your twice a year.
No. That's the other thing. We do that. We do that twice a year, the big recycle day where we take all that, plus, you know, rigid plastics and shredding and all that. So that would be available. And also, we have the hazardous waste collection day. That's available. So there's not like there aren't any other options. But, I mean, this would be one of the things to think about.
Do you get a lot of activity on those Saturdays, 7 to 3? Is it, or you just stand there and
we get some activity.
It looks pretty quiet to me.
Yeah.
The fact that it opens at 7 during the week would accommodate a lot of people that they could drop stuff on the way to work.
I mean, that would be a savings of, you know, not a lot, but, you know, something you can think about, or even, you know, do, you know, not to say eliminating, but doing once a month or something like that. I mean, that's a possibility. The downtown street sweeping, we do the Main Street starting in March and right through Christmas holiday celebration down there. You know, and occasionally we get a, especially in the fall, we get a couple people out there with blowers. Because I always get the email first thing in the morning. The only way to get the blowers out there is, you know, 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning without any cars, so blowing everything on the street. But we get a few emails. I think Bob's got a few emails over the years.
Yeah, we're moving residential downtown, so that problem's going to
get
more interesting.
Well, yeah, you also hear if for some reason you didn't get out there with the blowers.
Yes, indeed.
Exactly.
You may not.
Yeah, exactly.
It's kind of like you can't win.
But again, you're blowing leaves like in front of businesses.
Well, just leaves. Yeah. Well, you know. Yeah. Yeah, downtown trees. Yeah.
Less leaves and more just kind of.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah. Yeah. The holiday tree lighting program. That's what it is, and that's just the cost of us doing that. It takes, you know, the crews about a month to do that, and
which
know.
Is separate from the thing.
Right.
The chamber funds.
Right. This is just the stuff. This is. You know,
well, Jeff, you can kind of do what I do, which is you just put them up and never take them down, so you're only you know, the cost. And just don't turn them on. Like,
I used to do that.
January to, you know.
Yeah, they actually look probably nice in the summertime. You know, nice little.
Oh, yeah, just
every day's a holiday.
That's right.
Yeah, never take them down.
And the last one, you know, the Friends and Family Day. I mean, we go there with our guys. You know, we park there with our equipment and vehicles, and you know, it's a nice thing to do, but you know. Costs, you know, $8,500 to do that. So again, I put these up to think about things that just to generate some discussion for the board. Just to,
these are all good points.
You know,
good points.
Now that Friends and Family Day, is that Friends and Family Day separate from the Fall Street Fair?
Yes.
Yeah.
False refare is a, will be a similar scenario, although we get reimbursed for that.
Right, and I thought that that was, you know, because there is a source of income.
When you bring your trucks down there, the kids climb on them, and that, they do that for fall, not the fall fair.
Friends and family.
That's the June, that's the June.
Right.
Yeah.
And people love that, I mean, it's a nice thing to have, but. I think that's all they have.
Stay up.
Jeff, do you have that, or Bob, Jeff, can someone email?
Yeah, we'll collect that tomorrow.
Okay.
Questions for Jeff?
You might as well stay there.
Yep.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
I especially appreciate Jeff, that last page.
Yeah.
Because it's not a suggestion that, I didn't see it as a suggestion to go away, but it's in the big discussion of, you know, fiscal management, certainly looking at all of this valuable, so. No other questions?
No.
We good?
Yep, so that does finish off the general fund, which is kind of the more important one, if you will, but, you know, you will be asked to set rates for the water, sewer, stormwater in the next few months, and obviously town meeting approves those budgets. This should probably take me 5 minutes or maybe 10 to get through.
Because Paul said she's leaving.
Yeah, I know, she's kicking me right now.
She's kicking me with it.
Generally speaking, the water and sewer accounts are things you can plan. But there are some factors that are very much out of our control. If you look on this page, there's two sets of costs. The MWRA assessment is about a third of the budget, and that's something we have no control over. And those are the actual current forecasts from the MWRA for the next 5 years.
What the fluctuation?
That's what they forecast. What they actually target is combined rate stability. So if you're just a water community or a sewer community, it doesn't help you. And in fact, as you'll see, our assessment in sewer is a much higher percent of our budget as it is
right.
for almost every community. But they target stability and combined rates. So you can see they're not at all stable individually. When we see a plus 8.9% forecasted rate, and my guess is it'll come in a little lower than that, we use reserves and we use discretion in the local expenses as best we can to cause stability in the total picture. So you can see at the bottom, you know, we're trying to be in the 4.5 to 5% area as a target. Now the MWRA is frankly the most volatile of all the costs here because it just their forecasts change usually every year. The 8.9 is the highest forecast I've seen for water in several years from them. It's been a lower number. And then you can see in FY21 a 14% is, you would think they have a way to smooth out those next 4 years, but we'll see.
Bob, do you believe that with an 8.9 like the next 2 years?
I don't believe it's going to be 8.9. I think you could cut it 1% easily off it, maybe 2. But the fact is, we have to go with their estimate for now. You don't have to when you set rates.
I understand, but the next 2 years, do you believe that they fall off a cliff? And
yeah, that's all debt service related. So that's fixed costs.
One year?
Yeah.
I think 68%.
A lot of their debt is paid off in FY18.
When does our buy-in? I know we borrow for the buy-in. When does that?
Yeah, that's coming up, but it is interesting. I did look. The buy-in alone and the demolition of the old treatment plant is 15% of the water budget still. So, but as you'll see, when that 15 goes away, something else replaces it.
Well, Bob, I noticed in FY18 you have an offsetting reserve of 500K.
Yep.
MWRA is up 8.9. Yet in FY21, MWRA is up 14.4, and you've only got an offsetting reserve of 50?
He's trying to smooth. Yeah, that's because we're trying to smooth this bottom number out, Dan.
You only need 50 to smooth that out with a big increase like that?
Yeah. If everything else behaves on the top line the way I've put down.
Why are we so strong in 18 and 19 on the local raises?
I'm sorry, say it again, John.
In 18 and 19, you're at over 4%, and we
this is a negative, and this is a positive.
Oh, I'm sorry, my eyes are bad. Yep, thank you.
Hasn't it been our history with the MWRA, though, that they forecast high?
Yes.
Almost always?
Always.
I mean, if I need to look back on our own history versus actual, it's a stunning difference.
They will actually say to you, or at least Jeff and I, take 1% off what we forecast, wink, wink. In other words, it's more.
Well, and, but, you know, in part of the, you know, kind of the strategic partnership talks with North Reading, that it really did come out.
Yes.
At the actual, and their forecasts are, do they just want to feel comfortable?
Their actual, well, they want to make people happy by saying it's going to cost a lot and then make it a little lower. That's honestly all it is.
But this is
under promise and over achieving.
Right, always.
It's a little marketing.
We're cutting our costs. It's only up 7.9%.
But this is the spend, right? So you still have to put the consumption factor in here, right?
That's correct.
So if that continues to, although it's flattened out, if it trends, these increases of 4% could go dramatically higher.
Right, because we're using less.
Yes, because if we have to spread it over a lower use.
Correct.
Yep, the prices, this is the budget.
I mean, 4.5%, 5% is, no one's gonna be happy with that, right?
Yeah, this isn't talking about the rates up to the actual user.
But I'm saying the real rates are gonna be north of that, mostly.
Hard to say. I think we over-adjusted last time we did it on purpose with a one-time kind of shock. Based on continuing conservation, you'd be okay for a few years, but.
No prop two and a half.
We also have growth, so in theory, we've got, you know, for the extent we have fixed costs, we have more people using water.
You gotta use more water.
And our water use is actually up.
And last we put it in red or orange, it is up, slightly up.
I think it's because we have kids in the house.
Well, we have more people as these projects.
Yeah, we do have more people.
Themselves, you know, on the fringe.
Just talk a little about water. There's three parts of local costs effectively. Wages are up a slight amount, a little more than 2.5% because of overtime. Maintenance costs, different kinds, and some insurance, health insurance being one, could drive some of our expenses up. And the thing we can manage a little more carefully is capital and debt, so that's down. We have a $400,000 increase in the debt budget because we're doing a $3.5 million improvement over 10 years, and then we just decreased capital spending to allow that. And sort of from a longer term perspective, this $3.5 million debt issue would complete the first four planned phases. Unfortunately, your infrastructure is constantly in need of rehab. It's just, you can't finish it. It's like roads, you're never gonna finish paving. So it gets us only 1/4 of the way done.
The next one's a big jump, right? It's like
the next one, you know, depending how we split it up, in this fund, there's a lot of repairs left to do for a lot of money. Minimum, if you were to do them all right now and you could wave a wand to do it, it's 25 to 30 million. When we get to it, it's going to be that much more. And then when you talk about debt service, you're paying interest, you know, it's a lot of money. But the point here is we can't even begin the second phase from a financial standpoint in FY25.
Can't afford it.
Because you're just going to shock rates up by borrowing more money. And the other point is, you know, the general fund and the enterprise funds are related in a couple ways. The enterprise funds do pay for staff hours out of the general fund, so a portion of my salary, a portion of Jeff's salary is paid for in the offset, and Sharon's in charge of all that. But it's important to note that, for instance, we cut an engineering position a year ago, and we had a vacant engineering position for several months this year that I asked Jeff to leave open until we knew what the budget would look like. And when we have general fund staffing resources low, that affects the enterprise funds too. So, you know, in addition to prices of capital repairs limiting how much you want to do, we actually have occasionally a staffing bottleneck. How much work can we actually do? We have a 5% policy on debt and capital in the general fund. We don't really have that here. But what kind of capital you're doing makes a big difference on how much staff time is involved. If you're buying a fire engine for $800,000, that takes a certain amount of time out of the chief and the assistant chief, but it doesn't take a whole lot of time out of DPW's budget. If you're doing $800,000 worth of, you know, a Killam Field project or a road work or anything else, it's a lot of their time. So we're trying to plan that a little more carefully because we have less resources in the general fund. And then the MWRA buy-in costs, Barry, fully repaid in FY28. That's the last part. So again, 15% of the budget then goes away, and then we can speed up some of the infrastructure work a little. But honestly, it's very difficult to forecast the water rates going up less than 4 or 5% a year forever, if you want to keep your infrastructure in good order. And I will tell you, much like Jeff's comment on roads, communities don't always do that. And that's why, you know, I'm not even going to say anything, because I don't want anything to happen tonight. That's happened in the past. The sewer budget is actually quite different than water. The rates are similar, so the appearance is similar. But
the MWRA absolutely, if you will, has us hostage here. 81% of the budget is their assessment. You can see again, their first year assessment is low, and that's in their mind that offsets that 8.9% in water because they're doing a combo. But a sewer increase, you know, hurts us a lot more, if you will. You can see that in FY20 when they have a 7% forecast. They're almost paying off some of their biggest capital projects. So I would say from a capital standpoint, from a debt standpoint, the MWRA sewer system is in better shape than water. Water, they still have work to do. So we're not as vulnerable, you know, we're vulnerable in the sense it's 81%, but I think their annual run rate, although it's much higher here, oh, no, it's actually lower. It's 3.6, they're 5.6 in water. In the past, their sewer rates have gone up higher than water, and now it's flipped, and I think that's good for us because, again, we're more vulnerable to sewer. You know, I'll get to that big number, 48%, in the next slide. Obviously, we made a big change. But similar picture, a tiny bit lower, you know, 4 to 4.5% roughly for sewer is our target. And again, we can engineer that to a degree. Here, again, wages and expenses are really almost flat. Not change. It's the debt and capital where there's a big change. We've added $140,000 in capital and $550,000 in debt. Specifically, we are doing a $2.4 million Charles D. Street sewer station repair that will begin in a year. I believe it's paid for over 5 years, so the first year's cost is $550,000. The Charles Street project, much like the water long-term look, gets us a little further along, if you will, in terms of being one-third done instead of one-quarter, if that's how you wanted to measure it. There's some really big projects upcoming, though. Sturgis is I don't remember the size, it's a pretty big one. And then Joseph's Way, I should say Brewer and Collins are behind that. Instead of having $25 to $30 million left to work as there is in water, it's probably more like a $6 to $10 million figure in sewer. So our infrastructure in sewer is, if you will, in better shape from a cost standpoint, from an expected cost standpoint.
Those station repairs are all about $2.5 million.
They're very variable. Yeah. Depends on the size and the age.
Charles is the biggest one. Charles.
Yeah, most of them are less, John. And again, just as a reminder, we're very vulnerable to the MWRA costs. In both water and sewer, our target reserves are somewhere between 1.75 and 2 million. We're healthfully above that. I don't know the number, but we may even be around 3 million right now. So you can continue to use reserves the way it's been shown, and we're still fine. Plus, we can and do regenerate reserves much like we do free cash.
The vulnerability you describe is not any different for any other town in similar shape. We're not any comparatively worse off.
I would think not. That's an interesting question. You know, 20% of our sewer bill is local. I don't know what other communities are like, but it's probably pretty similar. We have less employees in the sewer department than we do in water, for a reason. I mean.
Flipping it around, the MWRA can have a hard time telling the entire Northeast that their rates are going up.
Yeah.
How do we regenerate reserves in water and sewer?
We sell more water than we budgeted. That's the best way. So everyone turn on their taps. And by the way, our sewer assessment is also based on water usage. So. We don't spend as much money on capital, but sometimes we don't do a capital project, we just cancel it, and then it shows up again. One of the recent years, I know we canceled a $700,000 or $800,000 one, so that put a lot of money into reserves. Those are the two primary ways. Sometimes our forecast on conservation is conservative, is wrong, so we actually do sell more water than we had budgeted.
You never get it right.
And in addition, it's really hard to forecast with this growth we have what that means for water rate usage. You've seen in the last, I think it's 5 years or so, the population's up about 10%. You wouldn't know it from the water usage because it's still lower. It's crept up in the last 12 or 18 months, but generally it hasn't. So it's a really hard thing to predict, but generally, just like everything else we do in finance, we try to be a little conservative. That means you will get some regeneration. Unlike free cash, though, I don't think there's a predictable amount. It's not $1 million every year, certainly.
looks like.
But in that circumstance, you're setting rates based on last year's demand. If this year's demand grows up, pops up, you're going to see healthy reserve regen.
Yeah, that's actually the kind of the perverse side is,
right.
You know, you do well when there's consumption up and you do very badly when you miss the other way. We've only missed once the other way in the last 10 years.
Yeah, we still have a watering ban, you know, in the summertime. For
that's mandated by the state.
I mean, it's probably the right thing to do because of conservation.
Yeah, we're supposed to have that watering ban, so I'm not allowed to tell everyone they couldn't really water their lawns. But it's really an individual choice.
Mr. Chair, one topic related to this, which is outside of the budget, is I've been hit up by a couple of neighbors on a perennial topic of dual meters for lawn watering.
I think we've all heard that.
I can't see a downside if they pay for it and they spend more money on water. I think we've already decided selling more water is a good thing. We can take it up at a later date, but I just want to get it on the radar.
The second meter thing, I think, is going to spawn a whole discussion. It bears a lot of, where do we go with it?
I agree. I just want to get it on the radar.
And so I don't think there's any question that over the course of, I think probably the next month or so, we've got much bigger fish to fry.
Agreed.
That's not a small thing.
It's just tricky.
There are downsides to it.
I'll also just bring up, because a resident has specifically asked, there's at least one community, and honestly I don't remember who it is in our peers, that offers a discount for seniors, so just throw that on your radar. I have no idea how we'd implement that, track it. But
there's no state law there, that's all up to.
That's a completely voluntary thing. I figured the senior tax relief in the first year is a good start, and after that we can...
Assuming consumption is a little bit lower for folks like that anyway. But.
Actually another point is you can tier water. That's probably a little more popular than it had been 10 years ago.
Yeah, a number of communities do that.
So what does Winchester have, 3 tiers, I think?
Yeah, based on consumption, based on,
That helps you. So that's another whole full discussion.
But did they do it in the opposite of the way you'd expect it, so that if you're using a little bit of water, your rate is high?
Opposite.
It accelerates. The rate accelerates.
Against us.
Yes.
Right. So the theory industrial is, user, if we haven't had it, that would
I was just going to say, a heavy water commercial use would be paying proportionally more of a water bill than doing
a... Paying a higher dollar per cubic foot. It's
doing, the water part, is that what you're talking?
It's doing evil.
Exactly. But those are the other ways that people price their product, that's all I'm saying.
But in general, selling more water is a good thing, right?
Well, it's a good thing until the MWRA has to charge you for it. So, yes, it is from a budget standpoint, a rate standpoint, but it eventually catches.
But they're only charging you for the...
They charge you for what they sell.
Yeah.
So if you use more, they charge you more a year later.
But that's their capital cost divided by your usage. It comes back as a fixed expense, not a variable.
In terms of a rate, yes.
Okay.
In terms of a pure rate, not the amount of your bill, more usage is always good. Your rates will be lower, their rates will be lower.
Right.
But in terms of what the water bill is...
But the bill will be the same. The bill will be the same. You just pay less per...
You're saying that many municipalities do exactly the opposite when they create tiered systems.
Correct.
So, once again, the pretzel logic of government never ceases.
Somebody's got to pay the subsidy.
Okay.
So that's all for...
Any other questions?
Oh, sorry, stormwater. My apologies. Stormwater is unchanged. That's
oral stormwater. Comes up at the end of the time.
Really nothing that interesting in this fund other than the new federal regulations are out. With the just local work we have, even aside from any federal regulations, as soon as we're willing to consider an increase in the $40 per household cost, we can do these drainage projects. As you can see, there's 3 of them for almost $2 million combined. They are important to do. The only question is if you don't want to go above $40 a household, these projects will have to be spaced out over time and the debt will have to be spaced out over time.
What was the last time we touched that rate?
You haven't.
Yeah.
Since it started at $40. Actually,
it
went down to 36 and collectors got too many complaints, so we went back to 40.
They wanted a round number.
They hadn't noticed it on their bill before until it became 36, something different.
Oh, I see. It's called attention to it.
What's this $36?
Oh, golly, where's Bill?
10 years?
This guy's in his bedroom. Make a call, of course.
A little less than 10 years.
Oh, yeah, so
8 years, maybe?
Probably time for lunch.
Nine, 10 years, just before I came.
Yeah, it's worked well. I mean, this would have been cost that would have been in the general fund, so from that standpoint.
What's the value of this, that revolving fund at the moment?
400, 500,000. And again, another decision for the board is there's more requirements coming. The past discussion with town meeting is new stuff goes in here, but that's always an open question.
And have we used, have we touched that money?
What do you mean?
Have we used it, or is it just accumulated?
Well, there's a reserve fund, much like water and sewer. But, you know, more or less, we're charging people what it costs to do the work.
They're doing work here, they're cleaning up them.
Yeah. You know, there is a couple hundred thousand.
Drain traps.
In the reserve fund, actually, it might be higher than that. It's like 800,000 or something.
Yeah.
So that's the end of the enterprise funds.
Any questions on any of those or from the public?
Bob, would you be inclined to create a, this is maybe perverse, but to have a separate revolving fund for those river projects, those kind of heavy duty projects, a separate, you know, this is kind of the steady state rate, right? And then you have this big stuff coming. Do you really want to have one fund, or would you rather have these two?
I won't, I'll speak financially and that makes sense, but legally I don't know.
Okay.
There's no reason you can't do the big projects under the general fund. I know that. I know what that sounds like, but no rules. You know, you can do a debt exclusion for them under the general fund.
So that'll be popular.
Okay, so you're all set, right, Jim?
Yeah.
Thanks. We've been working on the agenda for the 24th.
Yep.
Yeah.
And trying to clean it up in a way that would allow us to have, we have a growing list of topics that we've raised over the course of the last two or three nights for general discussion, the kind of general discussion that we like to have.
Yes.
Certain information that we've got to gather in order to be able to probably do that, you know, and have material in our hands. So Bob and I have been working on that. The plan at this moment, there's a couple of things to think about. One of them is that on the 24th, we've got a previously postponed alcohol hearing that we really can't. It would be good to be able to come back here so that we could have more room for the public on that night, I think. But I think we're going to run into a problem.
Well, I'm still waiting for an answer from town council. My guess, and it is only a guess, is that you are only going to have two choices. One is you can continue the hearing from the 24th to another date and then move the location of the meeting to the 24th, or hold the meeting where it was continued to in town hall. I don't know if there's a third choice. It was your selectman's policy on alcohol and Ray Meyer's.
You're really expecting a crowd
that
under part of this place?
Get together on the 25th.
That's the financial
form.
Well, that will be in the library.
Oh, that's true. Library's fine.
Matter of fact, we've heard from the chairman of FinCom confirming the 25th.
Okay.
I would say that is more likely to be the much more active public meeting, because it's going to be board interaction.
But that's a FinCom meeting. We'll be in session.
Well, it's a financial forum.
We'll be in session.
Yeah, we'll be in session.
And we will
we
be
have
in
a forum.
Session
we'll be in session
on the 25th. And the way that the FinCom chair has billed this meeting, per our discussion last night, really with him, was that we would bring all the topics to bear, including the discussion of, you know, it'll be the only time or the first time we will have been able to do it as a collective group of elected board relative to the last override that was on the ballot. Obviously, it failed to pass by a large margin, but, you know, what were the lessons learned from that? And, you know, what is the message that comes out of that? I mean, so these are all things that I think do bear discussion without. And we have all said through the course of these budget discussions that we want to be sure that we're looking at everything in the bigger picture of the things that the challenges that the schools are facing, and they're acute and, you know, right in front of us. And we've all heard from members of the public about that. We've heard some of that public comment, and so that's an acute issue. I think some of the things, personally, I think some of the things that we've heard, particularly in day one and day two, give me pause for further discussion that I think we should have as a group, notably in the area of public safety. I think that that bears discussion for sure. And how do we solve that? Is it solvable? So the question becomes, we will be participating in session at the Financial Forum on the 25th.
Is there an agenda or time an agenda is expected?
There'll be an agenda. I mean, that agenda will be coming. We don't have it yet because it was just confirmed. It's not even posted yet.
Do you want to have input into it to help shape the discussion?
Certainly. If you have, suggestions,
it strikes me that we probably should have suggestions.
What I would suggest you do then is forward those suggestions after tonight directly to Bob,
okay,
so that we don't get ourselves in the middle of inappropriate discussion from the standpoint of the public, because we want to, as we always have, you know, the idea of us, of our discussions of the open are, you know, not only required, they're valuable, and I think they've worked well for this board over the course of the last couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Dan.
Mr. Chairman, it seems to me you're saying if we are going to talk about issues relating potentially to a second override in April, those will not happen prior to the 24th, the 25th?
Well,
is that what you're saying?
Unless they happen tonight.
Well, Bob, let me ask you this. From the standpoint of the calendar and developing budgets, does that comport with your deadlines if we wait till then to potentially have to develop a second budget?
I think you're already too late, frankly.
It's going to be
a scramble.
Yeah, I understand it's a scramble.
You know, I don't know how to approach FinCom in March with two budgets.
It's been done.
I'm sure it has. So we'll just have to footnote things.
Right.
So that is the challenge.
Just to explain, it's a big difference between the town budget and the school.
Well, what I'm getting at, if we wait 2 weeks for that to happen,
not
is that
going to make any difference. We're already there.
We're already too late.
We're already through that.
Yeah.
Well, the window is.
I'm not understanding that.
Yeah. So, for example, I mean, our budget compared with the school budget, very, as we all know, very different, especially in the way that they're reported. The budget that we sit in advisory capacity on for the town, which is really what we do, it's not our budget, it's Bob's budget.
Granted.
And we've heard it over the course of the last 3 days. And so that budget needs to be prepared and shipped off. Stop me where I'm wrong about this, mm-hmm. Bob. Has to be prepared and shipped along for approval at town meeting.
Yeah, under the charter.
Yeah. What are the key dates? Why don't you go over the key
dates? The key dates have passed. Under the charter, I must present a balanced budget to the finance committee in the middle of February.
Yes.
A balanced budget does not include any future override.
Right.
So that's my first responsibility. So a budget similar to the one you've just seen for the towns,
mm-hmm.
and similar to the dollar value of the schools is what FinCom must see.
Correct.
If an override in April is discussed, both the schools and the town have to almost create some kind of appendix or an addendum of if more money came, here's what we do.
Right. All right.
But FinCom can't vote on that in March. They could take some kind of a secondary vote if an override.
FinCom can develop, it's right in their manual, they can develop two budgets.
Yes, but they must do the first.
Right.
Yeah. So
they can vote.
The second
on
one's going to be an iteration on the first.
Right. So what we would need to do is to say, okay, let's just, you know, pick a number. If there was an override of $3 million, to go back to the schools and help us, you know, what were the priority items that we would be that would cover in that override? And then
Let's talk about this in a totally hypothetical way.
Right.
So attaching a number is not a good thing.
Right. So here are the things that we prioritize. I don't know what the schools will prioritize. We might prioritize A, B, C, and D. And there's a cost to each one of those things.
Correct.
So if an override goes out, if we decide and we have the time that we want to go back to the voters again and just, you know, with some type of a reduced thing, we'll be able to say, here's your budget, and if number to be determined gets passed, these are the things that will get added into the budget and it will last a certain amount of time. And those are the things that we prioritize. And I would view the 25th as a way to kind of begin that. So it's almost like prioritizing. The other thing you can do is say, okay, well, if we raise fees that we're going to generate X amount of dollars, these are the things that we would want it to pay for.
Well, those are some of the items that we have discussed over the course of the last 3 days as agenda items for a open financial discussion of the Board of Selectmen on the 24th. Am I wrong about that? I mean, I thought that's what we were pointing.
I thought we were pointing to the 25th. Well, it doesn't matter to me either way.
You have time after 9 o'clock on the 24th.
I think we need to get our ducks in order on the 24th.
We structured that for an 8:30 discussion.
Okay, because I was going to say, because originally we talked about it getting off at around 9:30 or 10.
Right.
No, it would be, Bob and I
give me a chance tonight.
We're working on an agenda right now.
You need to sit at the kids' table.
Yeah.
Give us more time to talk about financial matters.
Okay.
Which is essentially based on
continuing
conversation that's had gone on here for 3 days.
Part of which is continuing.
I hate this place.
So we can be here. Is that what you're saying?
No.
I'll wait and see what is legal first.
Okay.
My suggestion is that we do not continue that here, that we finish it.
Mm-hmm.
So then we're going to be across the street.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, the most important meeting for a larger public audience, in my
25th.
Opinion, and three elected boards is going to be, and it is scheduled, and it will be scheduled for one of the library rooms. Okay? And that's going to be on the 25th. And so, I mean, I've heard from the chair. Matter of fact, as I walked in the door, I got something tonight about that. So, you know, the idea of us moving here, I think we may not be able to do it,
right,
unless we continue that hearing. And I don't think that's
you may not even be able to continue the hearing that way. That's what I need to hear back on.
Yeah. Okay.
So we're working on that. But I think we do have to agree that we're going to set aside, I'm just letting you know, that we've built this agenda so that we've got an hour and a half or two to do what we do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, often at the end of meetings, and almost always, and that is discuss the matters of the day. And the most important matters of the day are related to finance, in my opinion, especially based on our conversations over the last several days. And I think that would be a time and place that we could talk about fees. We could talk about the absence of certain services that one or more of us may feel is a problem based on what we heard from the department heads tonight. It would also be a time to talk about, we've heard from many citizens who are imploring us to think about an April override. Yeah, John.
So there's a thought rolling around my head today on this, and let me get the thought out. We all sat in a room with the school committee and spoke to each other about the value of the original override. And as I recollect that meeting, most of the school committee was in favor of 9%. Those on the Board of Selectmen.
9 million.
Nine million, thank you.
Right.
Yeah.
Some members of the Board of Selectmen were in favor of amounts somewhat below that, and we finally voted where we did. And in that room, there was angst that it was at 7.5 million. There was open disagreement that it was at 7.5 million.
And being too low.
As being too low.
Right.
Yes.
All those people in the room are still here. And somehow we have to reconcile with the fact that all of the smart people in the town thought what they thought and came to 7.5, and yet suddenly, 3 weeks later, we're all thinking, oh, that was wrong, and we now know why it was wrong, and we have a better idea.
No,
this can't be just picking.
Well, that's not the way I look at it.
That's not the way I look at it either. But
I mean,
there are a lot of things have changed since when we sat down and voted that number. One, the school litigation, which was about $3 million of that override, has now been taken care of. So that's
school litigation was
never
zero.
Part
well,
of that.
Part
of
it was
zero.
The
public
cap.
Perception was not that
yeah,
way.
But it was never
right,
part of
that. That conflated, unfortunately.
Increasing the capital.
That came out 5 days
right.
before the vote.
Increasing the capital. Okay, so that.
Parents, litigation was clearly not one.
In fact, we went to great lengths to prove
yeah, yeah.
that it wasn't because
we're talking about perception, John.
We knew about it the whole time.
The perception was different.
The
can't be that. It wasn't that. My point is a different way.
Wait, just shut off the electronics.
My point is, there's a bit of an echo chamber we find ourselves in, and I think we got to get re-baselined into what's going on, and that's all of the committees working together. What is the new, what is this, the, where are we now? And let's all just get baselined. The second thing is, I'm really frustrated on one hand, and I understand on the other hand why I'm getting emails from the community over, please have an override in April. It's not that easy. It's not up to us to make the override pass. We can try, we can implore, we've done all the open listening sessions. You know that better than anyone.
Yes. Yeah.
It's up to the voters who say, you know what, I agree with you. The third issue, and this is, I think, the grill in the corner of the room, I think there's a trust issue. And I don't know how to resolve it. I think part of the problem, yes, Barry, I believe it is true that the TLT litigation didn't help that. That was a good part of it. I still think there's an element of trust. And it's not just this board, it's all the elected boards in terms of, do you guys really know what you're doing? And I don't know how to solve that problem by April. I don't know, and if we rush to judgment with, a, hey, let's do a three. Does three sound good to you? Does three sound good to you? That's not how we do these
things. I'm not suggesting that we do it in April. I'm not even suggesting a number. I'm suggesting that we talk about it, because another thing that's changed is that, yes, we talked about, well, if we don't do an override, there's going to be this amount of cuts, we're going to lose this amount of FTEs in the schools, we're going to lose this amount of FTEs on the town side. But we didn't really understand, that was a number. We didn't understand the magnitude of what those services were going to be. The school committee did their budget, and having sat in that room when the superintendent made his presentation, sullen and somber don't even describe what it was.
Yeah.
And people are now kind of understanding and getting their arms around the fact that when you lose 18 FTEs, this is what it means. You're going to lose language in the middle schools. You're going to forget about a public safety officer. Forget about health.
Sure.
So now it's like, it's not just a number. It's now reality, and that's starting to sink in people, and sort of figuring out that's not acceptable. So the idea of coming back with a smaller number, whether that's to be determined, whether even strategically that's the right thing, can now address certain things. Like, okay, if we are able to put something out. And now specifically say, it'll now go to be A, restoring this, 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 and this. And then people will decide whether that's something they want to spend their money on. Now, I'm not suggesting that we even do that. You know, historically in this town, yeah, we let a year go by and we let it go
or
through.
Two.
Or two.
Yeah.
And so that's a choice. But I think, too, is that now we know what those cuts are. We know what the magnitude is. We know what the pain that it's causing in the community. I think it's worth making that discussion and saying to the community, if we come back with a smaller number, because also anecdotally, I think we've all heard people say, well, I would have voted for it, it was just too big.
Yeah.
Well, now, if it's smaller, and we say it's now going specifically and definitively
if
to A, B, C,
that's,
D, and E.
That's worth discussing.
A, B, C, D, and E, would you do it? And it's yes or it's no. And then if not,
so
we have our budget. That would,
I don't think you can actually steer the money, though, Barry.
You can. You absolutely can.
Yeah, but I mean, I think, you know, to go to the trust issue,
you can do line items.
It would just say, listen, this is what we're going to spend it on, you know.
Police salaries.
Keep in mind, though, the trust issue, I think, that John's talking about isn't one side or the other. It's across the board. So you can do that. You can earmark year one and say it's going to go this, and you're going to have people still voting against it because of that. And voting for it because of that.
John, you asked a fair question. And the fair question was, what's changed?
Right.
And Barry, I think that what you've talked about is one of the things that's changed. It came from, it morphed from a listening session and an FTE session to, here's what we don't have for police officers, here's what we don't have for fire. Here's what we don't have for language studies. Here's what we don't have for teachers. And I do believe, I agree with you, Barry, that it animates itself.
Yeah, put a face on it.
So that's one of the things that's changed. Here's the other thing that's changed since the last time we had this discussion. The voters made a decision based on a presentation method. And that presentation method was tied to a solution to a problem that was long-term in nature.
Mm-hmm.
That was multifaceted,
yeah.
And had room for add-ons, new stuff,
yep.
Had rooms for fixing structural problems, in the flow, and it had provision for carrying this out 8 years to a place when debt exclusions would fall off. So, now that we know...
The big idea won't work.
The big idea doesn't work. That the voters have said, are you guys crazy? Because when it's a 60-40 thing, that's the message.
Yeah.
You know, it's like,
yeah, right.
You guys did this wrong. Okay.
What do we do?
Yeah, so to me, the two things that are different is now we heard from the voters about the plan that we thought, and I still believe it made good sense, but it wasn't in...
It was the grand fix.
They were not prepared. The voters, who always, the voters are always the boss, said no. Okay, so I think it then becomes incumbent on us to first of all have a discussion and see if collectively we can come to a decision that actually might make more sense to more voters.
Right, and it may be that we don't.
Maybe we don't.
Maybe we don't do a grand fix for 8 years.
It's too late to even get there. I don't know. But
no, it's not too late.
I think, first of all, we're not going to get that figured out tonight.
No.
And my point in raising this was, I do think if we set aside a couple of hours on the 24th, we get our. I observe with this board of the five of us, we get our best work done when we're doing this. You know,
we need a round table.
Don't come back if you don't have to.
Paula's run for the door.
Yeah.
So
I wouldn't take notes from the ball.
He is secretary.
I am the secretary.
So I guess what
start
I'm
earning your wages here.
I think there's a lot to talk about.
There is, it's gonna take a while for that catharsis to work out, is all I'm saying. We can't go from where we are today to say X million, that's the right answer.
I totally agree with that.
Totally agree, John.
It's a process that we may have time to get done in order to, you know, have Bob jump through hoops and help us with dual budgets. Maybe not. We got to get it right.
Let me just clarify a comment that maybe it wasn't clear. When I said it's too late for two budgets, I mean two 200-page budgets. It's physically possible to do that.
There's no need for that.
It's physically possible to do one 200-page budget that meets the charter's demands, and then a supplemental handout that explains if there was more money.
This line item will look like this.
That's all I really meant.
Right.
Then
so
you
when
fix
I
it.
Pick up a budget, it is a formal legal document.
No. I don't think anyone.
Okay.
And I do think if we do our work on the 24th, it puts us in a better position to interact with the other two boards.
Yep, exactly.
That's all I'm saying.
So one of the agenda items on the 24th, I think fees has come up a number of times, and it's peanut buttered all over all of the budgets. We've really got to look at all, pull them all out and get them one by one and make some sort of assessment. Even if we don't have an answer, just directionally, what are we going to do?
Yep.
And when, you know, if we implement something,
when would it be?
I mean, you know, stickers.
What impact would it have?
If we did stickers, we couldn't do it until a year from now, which is really not the 18 budget.
So yeah, I think you're right. That's a huge problem.
What would the next one be?
Next biggest fee.
No, what would the next topic after we get all the fees? What do we want to cover?
You like the budget you saw in terms of would you get rid of something you saw?
That's a good point. Is there any other points?
Are there big holes?
Puts and takes. Were there additional puts and takes?
Yeah.
So that would be some. And the reason I'm bringing this up is so that Bob and I can work on something of a discussion agenda for that last couple of hours, so that all the things that we want to talk among ourselves on, and that the public can watch on TV or in person, that we've figured it out. Because look, guys, this is the only time we get to talk all together. We can't do it any other time because the law doesn't allow us to do that.
So another thought: this may be a stupid idea, but 70% of the spend isn't even us. We want to have some of that time with the school committee and have exactly the same conversation among colleagues and say, you know, look at fees, look at puts and takes on your 70%. We're doing it on our 30%.
I will tell you, as I have the opportunity to run into a school committee member off and on, I have suggested that strongly that they work harder.
Well, I'm not sure that, first of all, they're not having any kind of discussion on if we had more, this is what we put back, because they have to just go into the assumption that there isn't anything.
I'm not going to the more thing yet. I'm going to get in.
They may be talking about tonight.
going to the fees discussion. Before we get to the more, talk about fees and talking about any particular puts and takes that, you know, after three nights of sleep they'd want to make.
I think they've done that. I think they've done as much of that.
In the process still.
Really?
Is it worth it? They have more budget meetings.
Exactly.
They're meeting now.
Yeah, tonight and.
Yeah, they're meeting tonight.
Is it worth getting us together next week and having that grand?
I don't honestly think so. I think, and John Doherty and I have spoken about maybe having a chair, vice chair.
That's fine, we get you.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure when. You'd think sooner's better, but they're not through their budget yet. So it's hard to know. But before the.
I thought there was a checklist already established. I thought that when I looked at, and maybe it's a forecast I looked at, you know, in printed material.
Well, they might have something that's informal, but that they know of, you know, if they had X, they would do this.
I'm sure that.
They only agree for.
I'm sure they can give up a little quick rate.
The other material isn't.
Well, we certainly, over the last 3 days, have not made any secret that we're happy to talk about every financial issue that affects this town.
All on the table.
Now, what we have no control over is how the library trustees or how the school committee spends their money. I mean, we have zero to say about it.
But that's exactly why I think whether it happens as chairs or vice chairs or happens as a larger board, I think it's critical, because the town manager allocates cash to the schools. How they spend it is completely up to them.
Right.
But now we have to get agreement, I think, on, you know, guys, it really doesn't matter where you spend it. We're all going to get out of this as a team. We're all going to work together.
Well, it does.
It doesn't matter where.
Well, it does to this extent, because this board is the board that has to make the decision whether or not, if and when, an override is going to be, you know, proposed. So, yeah. And it's not a negotiation as much as it's an understanding.
Well, we're going to represent to the town what we've been told by the schools and the various, what they will do if that language is in. And you've got to have concurrence if that's the plan of record.
So, you know, just as an example, I mean, if suddenly we were going to have a lot of cuts.
I was raising his hand.
Yes.
No, that's okay. Go ahead.
If suddenly we were going to, not suddenly, we know there's going to be a lot of cuts.
Right.
And if the influx of money from an override would come in, to me, in order for me to personally, I can't speak for any of you, but for me to be able to vote to put any amount of override on any ballot, I have learned my lesson. And my lesson from the voters is as follows. Tell me what you're going to do, because we told them in a big general way what we were going to do, and that answer was not adequate.
Yeah.
And
well,
I, that was a
particular message. Do you mean having specific items on a ballot that says X amount
even,
of money?
I'm not suggesting that we drill down
here.
To, you know,
well, I'm not suggesting
buy a set of wrenches for the fire
well,
truck.
Let's
no.
at least talk about
well, that. I'm suggesting it might be a good idea, actually.
Well,
I mean, to your end, I think when you throw out a big number and people vote on it, it's very easy to say, no.
It is absolutely
no, 7.5, absolutely not. Get that away from me. But if it was broken down, maybe.
But so
maybe it's not. Maybe it's a better understanding in the actual, you know, when you grab your ballot and you're casting your vote. You know, you may look at it and go, oh, so it's going to be for this and this.
And that's, I guess, where I'm driving, Kevin. So I think we really are on one page about this.
I thought we kind of
okay.
did that.
Yeah,
I don't think you say 140.
No, we talked about what it would be, but we never act. You can actually put it on a ballot and say specifically year one.
Hold on a second, because you better clarify.
All right, go ahead, Bob.
You can do that only in line items the town meeting has votes on.
Yes.
So let's forget the override entirely and say, to John Arena's earlier point, we need to have a discussion with the school committee in order to create some difference in their budget to make the community happier.
Right.
Let's just simplify it. None of us have that authority.
Exactly.
Town meeting does not. You do not. The voters do not. They get a lump sum. They do with it what
only
they will.
Only the school committee can decide that.
So
yeah,
even so, if let's just make up something. There's a $500,000 item in their budget that they decided not to do, and something else they decided to do, and the community was in an uproar. Only the school committee can fix that.
But can the ballot question be worded such that that line item has any detail on
it? I thought when we discussed that
can
last
you double
time,
check
that, that
I know that that's
could.
True. That's Ed Rubin.
Yeah.
You can say for schools.
Oh, but you can't say what's a line.
But the school committee can take a vote and say, if we had $500,000 more, we would prioritize the spending on these items.
I don't disagree with
Wasn't there an 80-10-10 a while back? Like, it was like 80% schools and 10% libraries.
I hope it's never that high.
No, traditionally, what the spend...
I mean, there was an override vote, and the vote was for an amount, and it wasn't...
There was more detail. It was 80-10.
It was a percentage breakdown.
You're pushing dollars, you're not pushing a project.
Correct. Well, but it gets rid of the, it's a police officer and two teachers. It's just...
Yeah, my point's a little different. If the voter hears that the schools, if they get money, or the town, if they get money, will do X and Y, and that X and Y doesn't happen, I think that's a real...
That's a huge problem.
Because the whole premise is...
Probably the last time you'll get one approved.
This has now been twice, guys. You've disappointed me.
That'll be over.
My problem with this is I think you got one chance to get this right.
John, I do not disagree with that philosophy at all. And I just encourage exactly what we're doing right now.
Well, that's why I'd like my colleagues on the other side. Just let's have a nice round.
I don't know that we can get them together between now and the 24-25.
That's why I wouldn't want the date rigidity around the schedule of date before the behavior. Let's let the scope drive the schedule, not the schedule drive the scope.
Okay.
If I could just add.
Yes.
In terms of the school committee's exact authority, it's they have cost centers. I think it's five. I don't remember exactly. The regular day education is one of them.
Correct.
They can take a vote to do something very specific in terms of a teacher or a position or a function. And then town meeting approves that conceptually, and then they can do whatever they want. And the history of the school committee, I won't speak for what they'll do going forward, is I remember examples in the past where someone proposed to fund a position at town meeting if they would restore it, and their answer is, philosophically, we will never agree with that because we have bottom line authority. So if you want to add that $80,000, we'll consider what you've requested, but we will never agree to it on the floor of town meeting. I don't know if the school committee's changed, but that's what school committees are in this state from it.
I think the school committee, if they, I mean, after hearing their budget discussion, I think, you know, they could develop a priority of what they, and listen, it's up to them. I mean, if they say, listen, this is how, what we think are the most important, and let's say more revenue is then derived, and then they don't do it, well, then, you know, there's six people that'll have to face the voters. And, you know, I mean, I think there's some level, I mean, there's got to be at some point a level of trust where if they say, this is what we're going to do, that they're going to do it. I know we can, but I still have that legal faith.
Well, I mean, I'm happy to try to communicate this discussion and thought with, you know, kind of a chair, vice chair discussion. So, I mean, Kevin and I could certainly meet with the chair and vice chair.
I mean, we're going to lunch at 11:30 inside.
You do?
Good. Want to join?
Just throw it.
I don't know. I got to look.
All right.
But I'm happy to meet with them.
All right.
I mean, you know, we're not talking
just
about...
just the chair, not the vice chair.
You know, it's not like... these are people from a foreign land. These are people I see every day wandering around the center. So
that's why we got to lunch at 11:30.
I just don't know what the schedule is. I don't know what's going on.
But thinking back to these are people that are our friends, our neighbors, people that we see socially. It's not a question of who they are. It's just we're all in this together. We're in this pit. We've got to figure out how to get out of it. Let's think together as a group. I know we're in different silos. But do we have to stay in different silos as it relates to planning our way out?
No.
I think not. I think that it's...
that's the
only
way we're
going to
get at
it. I mean, clearly, especially over the last couple of years, that we were happy to interact with any elected board or any other committee that reports to us. And when we do so, we tend to have pretty good results. I mean, at least we make forward progress.
So without specificity to the 24th or 25th, I think it's worth it, whether you guys do it privately or whether we try to schedule a Saturday or an evening to do it, I still think it's worth it. I mean, I'm willing to be overruled or
No, I don't think it's about overruling at all. I think that, you know, it's a...
It's a good suggestion.
Yeah, I think it's a good suggestion. I think the starting place is, let's get together with the chair and the vice chair and express the thoughts shared by all five of us here. And, you know, got to talk to Bob.
Yeah, I just have to add that, again, the school committee has a budget schedule, posted meetings, a plan going forward. They are not even scheduled to vote on their budget until after the 25th. So to interact with them at this point is definitely in the middle of a process. You have now seen the end of your process for a reason.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
They have not.
It's good.
They have a hearing on the 19th, I believe. So that's another reason why the schedule is kind of weird.
Right.
It is.
Right.
It forces you almost into February or March to have this conversation.
Which...
Well, I think...
February at a minimum.
And I will find out legally what the deadlines are, because if you're going to have a valid question, I know the latest deadline is February 28th.
Yeah. Right.
You have a meeting scheduled.
Is it the first?
Our last meeting is the 21st.
We can always add a meeting.
We can always add a meeting just for that.
But I don't know what other kind of, because it didn't dawn on me to think about it. I don't remember all the deadlines in advance. Remember last year, we were doing it this time of year for next September. There was a lot of different legal deadlines. I haven't prepared that. I know there are some.
Well, we were doing that too, more from a, I think more to explain, yeah, to explain information out to the public, which has already been explained.
Yeah.
And even differently, a different point of view on that is, Barry had talked about how this is now animated, and he's right. I mean, what we talked about philosophically over a period of 6 months is here.
Right.
And, you know, you can actually put a name and a face on it. In many cases.
We're not shocked. We saw it. Huh?
Well, it's not shocking to anybody at this table, I know.
Actually, you know what?
Because we were very clear about it.
How'd you get shocked?
No, I mean, obviously I knew it was going to, you know, it's like we knew it was going to be cuts, but it's like, oh, really? That?
Prophets are never honored in their own time.
Yeah. I mean, I wish I had Chief Sagala's handout in September and October when I was going and speaking in front of every PTO and anybody who would, like, have me and listen. And instead of, you know, it basically it's like, okay, we're going to lose a police officer, okay. But then hand it to say, okay, but this is what our police department is doing.
Yeah.
And this is the resources. And even Mr. Brown's thing from 1967, they had more, they had more resources with, you know, 25% less people. I wish I had that kind of information to talk about, because then it just says, wow, this is really deeper than I thought.
Yes, Bob.
You have to remember, though, that the override last time did not come quickly. It came after at least 18 months of planning and preparation on John Doherty and my part. And if you'll remember, the first and most important thing we said, aside from getting more money, is employee morale.
Right.
That was the reason we did not want to give very specific
answers
last September. So we said, especially John, number of FTEs. A little easier to say one police officer because we had retirement scheduled, so no one was thinking, oh my God, I'm going to lose my job. But you'll recall that I listed something like 8 to 10 FTEs by department as if we did it pro rata so that there was no accountability there on purpose. It's a very different thing to have laid out the budget you see right now last September. We could have, but John and I agreed we did not want to do that because the attrition would be phenomenal.
I still think that was the right call.
Oh, definitely.
I think if there's a lesson to be learned in the override, this is perhaps a part of it, but if you recall of the $7 million, $3 million was endurance, planning for the next 8 to 10 years. That was always a hard thing to explain.
Why do I want to pay for it now?
It's
got to
be in there somehow.
It was a very hard thing to explain. And then when you broke down the number by household, that's what grabbed it. So the two things I've heard most common from a no standpoint was, one, you asked for too much. You asked for more than you needed.
I heard that too.
And they didn't understand the whole, you know, $3 million on the back end kind of setup to try to stretch it out for as long as you could.
Some of the presentations were confusing. About
right. And then I think the second one was sticker shock. You see that number per household. Said, oh my God, this is going to come on top of everything else that's going on. And for those people, when the $6 million hit, that was it. Game was over in their mind.
People could get their arms. People got their arms easily around the structural deficit piece.
Right.
That was. That's a very.
And
people
add-ons.
Understand that.
And concept. The add-ons. That was 4.5 out of the 7.
Right.
The last 3 was always the hardest.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's fine. You don't have to do those 3. Theoretically, you'd be back in a year with a $500,000 problem every year.
that's really the point, is if you don't do the, what do you call it, endurance? You're back in 3 years.
Do you know something, though? I think that,
but maybe that's the trust.
I think people told us they want to look at it more often.
Yeah. I think that's part of the trust part that you're talking about, John.
The people that said, people that voted no, that have talked to me.
You wouldn't think that they would want to do that. But I think for somebody who has a trust issue, looks at, say, okay, you're going to have to come back in 3 years. All right, that's a little more justifiable in my mind.
See how you're doing. Right.
The fact that we came to them every 14 years didn't buy us anything.
Well, I said to Bob earlier today.
Yeah, but what's the changeover in those 14 years? How many people are voting on this one that voted 14 years ago?
I went to almost every PTO. This is actually an interesting thing, because I went to all the PTO meetings, and the first question I asked, who was here, who lived here in town in 2001, 2, whenever we did it? And maybe a third of the people raised their hands.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, so, think about the letters we've been getting. They start, a large majority of them start this way. We moved here 3 years ago. We moved here 5 years ago because we had an anticipation of a certain school system.
Yep.
Okay? Guys, you get the same letters I get, and they... huge majority of those letters start with that. And so they don't care when the last override was, honestly. And you know, I tend to really agree that we put people to sleep by doing the job, the management job, so well and getting so much and so little.
Paul's nodding your head.
What we did. So anyway, I think what we should do is Kevin and I will seek out the school committee, their chair and their vice chair, to open a dialogue. We are going to proceed as we just talked about with two or three general agenda items for the last 2 hours of that meeting.
Okay.
I think we are going to proceed and take care of that pending hearing that's open. I don't think we should get rid of that again, and I don't think we even can.
And just how long will that take? I don't remember how long.
I don't know, but we'll talk to Ray and try to streamline. So, look. This is. It doesn't matter how long this takes.
No. I'm just saying, is that going to be a long item or a short?
It's up to you.
You know, not on the alcohol.
You're talking about the alcohol license,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You've seen a preview.
You've seen the preview.
It's
the
only
policy.
Thing you haven't seen is a survey of peer community liquor license fees, and you'll see that.
Those will open your eyes in a very interesting way.
Let's not rush this. Let it take the time it takes.
Yeah.
You can't cram this into 2 days. That's what I meant by let the scope determine the schedule.
Yeah.
We'll
try
to. Yeah, we don't have to have a decision on the 25th either.
Remember this: we have to do our work, no matter what.
There's time.
We are where we are.
We have a scheduled date. We've done a little rearrangement to give ourselves more time for a more prominent discussion about the most important thing. So we'll proceed with that plan. We've been invited to join a financial forum with the other two elected boards. We, of course, should be involved in. That's going to be a great opportunity for us to talk, and then we'll see where it takes us. And Bob is going to stand at the ready on any other topics that any decisions that ultimately come out of that. And we can, how much notice do we have to give before we meet?
48 hours.
All right, so we can work around that.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Just remember, it is the winter and you can't always do what you plan.
That's why they have boots and four-wheel drive.
Why there's little orange trucks too.
That's right. I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Please.
So moved.
All in favor?
All right. Oops. Gentlemen.